Good morning and welcome to the fifth meeting of the Criminal Justice Committee in 2024. We have no apologies this morning, and I would like to welcome to the meeting the Right Honourable Dorothy Bain KC, Lord Advocate. So thank you for taking the time to attend today's meeting. It is very much appreciated. And I know that we've already heard from Crown Office officials and have had written evidence. However, there were a few very important issues that the committee felt we needed to ask you specifically about. So we are very grateful that you were able to join us today, Lord Advocate. So I intend to allow up to 60 minutes for this panel. And I propose that we focus our questions to the Lord Advocate on the proposal for a victims commissioner, and then move on to our questions on trauma-informed training, and then finally the abolition of not proven and changes to jury majorities. So I understand that the Lord Advocate does not want to make an opening statement. So if I may, I'll begin with an opening question on the victims commissioner provisions. So we understand that you have concerns that the provisions in the bill relating to the proposed Victims and Witnesses Commissioner might unintentionally interfere with your independence. So I wonder if you can outline just what those concerns are and any changes that you consider would be needed to address them.
So I understand that Laura Buchan and Alistair MacLeod both gave evidence about this matter and focused the concerns for the committee. What I would say is in relation to this matter is that the Crown Office and the Scottish Government have been working together on the issues outlined in the written submissions. And I did not and do not consider that the bill is incompatible with my independence. The proposals in the Crown's written submissions didn't impact on the intended powers of the Victim and Witnesses Commissioner, nor the accountability of the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service or the Lord Advocate in relation to the experience of victims and witnesses. I think the concern was raised that those reading the bill may consider that the Victims Commissioner could make recommendations which impinged on the Lord Advocate's independence on prosecution decisions and prosecution policy. But we are reassured that that's not the intention of the bill, and in light of further discussions I've had with the Scottish Government and the Crown, it's no longer being submitted that there requires to be any amendment to the proposed bill. So I think the process of sharing the written submissions to the committee and the exploration of the issues before the committee and then further work with the Scottish Government officials have resolved any of the issues that were of concern previously.
Thank you very much. I mean, that's a very helpful sort of update and sort of clarification, if you like, on that particular issue. So I suppose just by way of follow-up on still with the Victims Commissioner, obviously in the bill there are a number of proposals set out in terms of the role that the Commissioner would have. I'm interested in whether or not generally there might be anything else beyond what is set out that you feel would be relevant for a commissioner role to include that may not already be in the bill, or as it stands at the moment, are you supportive? And I think from your previous answer, you are supportive of what those provisions are.
So, yes. The Crown is supportive of the aims of the legislation to improve the experience of victims and witnesses and of the establishment of the Victims and Witnesses Commissioner. And the Crown recognises the importance of a single body who can promote and support the rights and interests of victims and witnesses in relation to both criminal justice agencies and third sector organisations. And the Crown would engage and collaborate with the Commissioner if the role is established. It's clear the Commissioner wouldn't have the power to interfere with the Lord Advocate's independence on prosecutorial decisions or prosecution policy, but the Commissioner would be influential on bringing a voice for the victims and witnesses in this area of work, which would be welcome and informative. And it would be a step that's radical and one that would require the Crown to respond to an influential body with the recognition that the victims commissioner would be given.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thanks very much for that. So I'm going to open it up to members now, and I think perhaps Pauline McNeill, I think you were maybe wanting to pick up on the victims commissioner. I'll maybe bring you in.
Thank you. Well, that was what I was going to ask you, actually, Lord Advocate. We have heard evidence, you're quite correct, from witnesses whose reading of the bill is that somehow this would give powers that could potentially cross over the independence, and not just of the Crown Office, but of other agencies as well, and this is clearly not the powers within the bill. So you've answered that already, but perhaps you agree that the government probably need to do a bit more work, should this be passed into law, to make sure everybody understands the role of the Victims Commissioner in relation to this point?
I think with any new role, and such an important role that's been granted, it's critical that the manner in which the role will be operated and the powers of the role are clearly defined and made clear in legislation and also in any policy memorandum, and any further guidance that would be issued on the development and the appointment of the role. So, as with everything new, there requires to be education for all who are involved in and around the issue. But you're quite right, Ms McNeill, about the restrictions on the role. But it is an important role, and one that will hopefully reflect well on the prosecution system in the future.
That was a good follow-up to that. We've heard quite a bit of evidence, and I've been really interested in particularly the evidence of one witness who had a very positive experience in recent times. One of those strands, if you like, of good experience is because they had access to the Advocate Deputy. So it's my question in relation to this is a question for me, considering the bill. Would that resource would be considerable to set up the Commission? I'm guessing John Swinney's in the room, can correct me if I'm wrong, about 20 million. Always starts off with a figure. Okay. Starts off with a figure. You'll closer, agree.
Closer to one, I would say.
Oh, closer to one. Okay. So closer to one. But that's a resource that might be able to be used elsewhere. And that's a consideration that the committee have got to think about. Just my question to you, Lord Advocate, is if the Crown Office was going to provide more access to advocate deputies for victims to have a better experience, would you need some additional resource for that? So is that a fair consideration as, again, spending money on the Victims Commissioner?
So the choice of spending is not for me. The choice of spending and where resources should be applied are for this committee, first and foremost, and then ultimately for Parliament. I think it's a very good question that you ask, and perhaps I could be allowed to give a reasonably extensive answer to that, because it does put into perspective a lot of what the committee is looking at. So I read the evidence that you're referring to, and I read the evidence of the mistakes, Yassim, Miss Ellis, Ashby, and also the victims who were in the Lee Doi case evidence. In relation to three of those cases, Stakes, Yassim, and name there, all of these cases were indicted well before my time as Lord Advocate. The case of Ellis, I think, came to trial in May 2022, but that was on the back of a very long period of closure for the courts, and I'm sure her case was heavily impacted by the COVID pandemic. The case of Ashby was one tried in 2023, and that was a case in respect of which there was positive evidence given about the interaction of the Advocate Deputy with the victim before court, and also the support that she got in relation to court visits and the like. She described a real sense of support, and she described how that helped her to be prepared for giving evidence in court. And I think I've previously said I've thought that was a very important part of the role of the Advocate Deputy, And I think it's of enormous importance that we properly support victims of this type of crime from the point of report all the way through the justice system. What's relevant to the availability of an advocate deputy for that support, and indeed the support for a victim before trial, is the resource that we can apply to that sort of support. Now, when I was appointed the Lord Advocate in June 2021, there were only 32 advocate deputies in post. And that's not because it wasn't recognised that more weren't needed or that there wasn't the budget for those individuals. It was because there was a real challenge coming off the back of the pandemic to encourage individuals to take up the very formidable role of an advocate deputy. When I was appointed Lord Advocate, I identified the enormous challenges with the numbers of advocate deputies that were in post, the huge pressures that put on the serving advocate deputies to deal with the level of work that they had. To be by way of example, they were dealing with 25 to sometimes 30 preliminary hearings per cycle, and the maximum that you can do well would be in around the number of 12. And we were just asking far too much of a very small group of people. And so the availability of individuals to consult before trial and actually to be given a case in good time before trial was heavily compromised. So I set about, when I was appointed, to really try to encourage people to become advocate deputies. It was a very important part of the work that I undertook immediately. I identified the huge pressures, I see, on the rota. I identified, in addition to that, the enormity of the evidential challenges that faced sexual crime, and I had in mind the Lord Advocate's reference in relation to evidence rules over distress. And I also, through the work that I'd done in private practice, promoting victims' rights, for example, in the case of WF against Scottish ministers and RR against Lord Advocate, promoting victims' rights, recognised that what was being given to victims of sexual crime just simply wasn't good enough. So I have set about seeking to improve the number of advocate deputies that we now have, which is at 70.5. We should have 77.5, but we still are challenged in and around those numbers. I took the Lord Advocate's references, and we have further references to take this year. I worked very hard on the rota with the very dedicated team of Principal Crown Counsel that I have, and I've been able to develop opportunities for early allocation of work. I've been seeking to inspire those within the service to recognise that the prosecution in the public interest encompasses supporting victims through the process and ensuring that they can give their best evidence. And so I think what you see in the case of 2023 is the positive developments in and around all the work that's been done. And I think that that is an enormous way that we can improve matters. So it's going to take more resource. Ultimately, if you need early allocation of cases, if you need better trained prosecutors, if you need more prosecutors, and you need a better support systems within the service itself, the Crown Office and Prosecutor Fiscal Service, is going to take a resource that we don't have at the moment.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. I'm going to bring in Russell.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Lord Advocate. I'm going to ask you about the Victims Commissioner, and you've preempted my question by saying that the initial concerns the Crown raised in their submission about the need to amend sections 16 and 17 have been allayed by conversations with Scottish Government. But just for clarity, is it the case that the initial concern was that a requirement on the Crown to respond to the Commissioner's annual report might have been seen as meddling in the Lord Advocate's independence?
You've got
whereas now you accept. So what was the nature of the conversation with the Scottish Government? Was the concern premature, or has it been, was there more explanation provided by Scottish Government?
I think there was more, there was a better exploration of the issue. There was a sharing of an understanding of the legislative provisions. There was a desire to understand what Scottish Government envisaged from legislation. And there's always, within the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service, a desire to ensure that we always continue to protect the independence of the Lord Advocate. So these are very important issues. People were concerned to ensure that the protections enshrined in the Scotland Act were not in any way compromised. And I would say all of the discussions and all of the concerns originated from a good place. And I can say that the matters have been resolved. And I know that the senior executive team in Crown Office discussed this issue and indicated also their contentment with what's proposed.
Thank you. Am I allowed to ask about other parts of the bill just now?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
I'm grateful to give you. If I could just follow up the question that Mr. Finlay has asked and the answer from the Lord Advocate. I wonder if what the Lord Advocate has put on the record is very welcome in this respect, but I wonder, it does beg the question in my mind as to whether any of that needs to be formalised beyond what has been the basis of agreement between the government and the Crown. Mm-hmm. And I wonder if the Lord Advocate would say, whilst we've reached a place of welcome understanding and that the independence of the Crown has been clarified and assured, I just wonder if the Lord Advocate believes there is any degree of formalisation required beyond what has been arrived at so far.
Well, perhaps I could reflect again on that point, Mr. Swinney. I understand that there's a contentment with the legislation as it's drafted, but perhaps I could take that away again and come back and specifically answer that question in writing, because it would be worth my exploring both with Crown Office officials and Scottish Government officials on that issue, because it is an important one, I see.
It might, for example, I'm grateful for that answer, Lord Advocate. It may be that it doesn't require legislative change, but perhaps a memorandum of understanding or something of that nature, but if that could be explored. And we can obviously explore that with the Cabinet Secretary when we see her next week. But I'm grateful for that clarification. Thank you.
Russell Pinley.
Thank you very much. In terms of trauma-informed practice, which is in part two of the bill, the Crown Office is in the process of implementing something called Trauma-Informed Justice, a Knowledge and Skills Framework for Working with Victims and Witnesses. And given that we're told this is already happening, I think, again, it perhaps begs what's been a recurring question, which is, do we need legislation to enshrine trauma-informed practice when, in fact, this is happening at your behest already within the Crown?
I think the embedding of trauma-informed practice as proposed in legislation is critical to the development of a criminal justice system that properly delivers on the needs for victims. So I think that the trauma-informed practice reflects not just the role of the prosecutor, but also those who work within the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service, from court staff through to the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service's responsibilities in relation to listing and managing business, and in addition to that, to the responsibility of the judiciary overseeing these very sensitive cases. So I think that whilst, yes, people talk about the fact that they realise what trauma-informed practice is now and are saying we are committed to it and we are providing training on it, I think the importance of embedding it in legislation means just it's there and people recognise that it's a statutory responsibility that has to be adhered to and can't be ignored. It's just not something that you sign up to by reason of wanting to do it or not wanting to do it. It's a compulsator that's critical to the development of the sort of sexual offences courts and the sort of prosecution system that those who are advocating for change really, really desire.
In what way does the framework differ from what the legislation will achieve practically?
So I can only talk about what the Crown are doing in relation to their trauma-informed practice. we have been highly influenced by the work of the agencies involved in providing Scottish Government's reports on these matters. I can talk about what the Crown's doing and what the framework means for that, but I can't really go much further.
It's more just the framework. I'm not fully up to speed on its contents or what it is going to achieve and how that might differ from what the legislation will seek to achieve.
So I suppose I can only talk about the Crown's response to this. I think it's important that we recognise that we work within a prosecutorial system that is adversarial, which means that there are certain constraints to the extent that we can offer, example, choice to victims and witnesses. Prosecutors act in the public interest and don't represent individual victims or witnesses. And this means that although prosecutors will take account of a range of factors, including a victim's views when reaching a decision, their views will not necessarily determine the decision we take. We also prosecute within the rules of evidence and the procedure of the Scottish legal system, which enshrines the rights of an accused person to a fair trial and places the responsibility for proving the charges against them beyond reasonable doubt on the prosecutor. Many of the cases that we are involved in require us to lead evidence from witnesses, and an accused person is entitled to cross-examine those witnesses during the trial. Inevitably, this will involve asking the victim to recall and speak about events which may be very traumatic for them. And all that said, many of the current processes already enshrine trauma-informed principles. These include the use of special measures to help vulnerable witnesses to give effective evidence, rules of evidence which protect complainers from irrelevant and inappropriate questioning, a better understanding of the need for courtroom advocacy to take into account the communication needs of vulnerable witnesses, recognition by the courts that where a party wishes to recover sensitive personal records relating to a witness, the witness should be given the opportunity to make representations, and the ability to take evidence from children and particularly vulnerable witnesses at a commission hearing before trial. So all of these processes are in place, but I do think that the way in which we then go on to train prosecutors and those who deal directly with victims throughout the service necessitates a development of a level of understanding that was absent previously, and the compulsator on us to do that is a very important one, and it's one that we've reacted responsibly to. So I suppose I hope that answers your question. I'm not really quite sure if it does, no, Mr. Finlay, but
thank you. I've got a general question, if that's okay, very quickly. We've got a submission from the Senators of the College of Justice, some of whom support the proposed pilot scheme and juryless rape trials and so on, and some of whom are opposed to this.
Yes.
And those who are opposed to it say that it may not comply with Article 6 of the ECHR and may not be within the legislative competence of the Scottish Parliament, and cites the Scotland Act, which you referred to in your initial answer to me about the independence of the Lord Advocate. I just wonder whether the Crown Office has assessed that particular warning they have made about this potential issue of legislative incompetence, and if so, how real that threat is, what's being done to address it, if anything, and what we as members should perhaps, you know, how seriously we should take that.
So I think the judiciary, like many other parts of the profession, are split down. I'm not sure what the proportion it was of the judiciary who indicated concern in the most latest submission about the proposal. And I think the highest that they came to in relation to these issues was it may breach Article 6 and it may impact, it may not be within the legislative competence of the Parliament. I didn't read their submission as having carried out a full legal analysis of that. That's my reading of it, at least, Mr. Finlay. What I know happened in the prelude to all of this work that's been done by the committee was that issues in around the concerns over Article 6 were considered with great care, as was the legislative competence of the bill and the view of the Scottish Government as senior legal advisor to the Scottish Government and head of the Prosecution Service and those within the service supporting me, is that the provisions of the bill are within the legislative competence of the Parliament and there's no breach of Article 6 in relation to the suggestion that you could have a jury trial, a trial without a jury. I think there's very sound case law across the board and indeed from the European Court of Human Rights that indicates that you don't need to have a trial by jury to have a fair trial.
Yeah, I mean, in their warning, they specify Section 29(2) of the Scotland Act. Does that relate to trial by jury?
Section 29(2) of the Scotland Act. I don't have it in front
no,
of me,
sorry.
But I think the point is, it may breach Article 6, which is the right to a trial, a fair trial,
right.
And it may impact on the Lord Advocate's. It may be relevant to legislative competence of the bill, but these matters were looked at.
You're satisfied that that's not the case, then?
Well, I was, yes.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. I'm going to just remind members that we're looking at parts 1 to 4 of the bill, and on that, I'm going to bring in Sharon Dowie and then John Swinney.
Thank you. I just want to follow up again on the points initially raised by Pauline McNeill on the varying experiences of witnesses,
yes.
And also the point raised by Russell Finlay and the requirement for legislation. We've heard from witnesses that came before us about the different experiences they've had, and just in the submission we've got in it that it should provide evidence there should be sufficient time for a court visit and meaningful discussions between the witness and prosecutor about special measures. And in another part, it then has prosecutors act in the public interest and do not represent individual complainers or witnesses. So do all advocate deputies, are they all supportive of spending extra time with complainers to explain the processes? Or is it down to what you said earlier on about the resources?
Well, my instruction to all of the advocate deputies is that they must meet a victim before they give their evidence in court. And I have developed, since my appointment, a system where in some of the very serious cases, we allocate an advocate deputy at the point at which the case is reported. We can do, and reported, that means reported into Crown Office for the Crown then to initiate proceedings. And we can't do that in every case, but in some of the very difficult cases that we've had, stranger rape cases and very, very vulnerable victims, cases involving children, at the point of report, I've allocated an advocate deputy. They've met the victim, they've talked through how they're going to give their evidence, how their evidence would be best taken. They've supported them in court visits, and they've met them at least twice before they give their evidence in trial. That is how I would like all of the cases to be done. But we simply cannot do that. We simply do not have the resource. And I think it is quite right to point out there's a distinction between the role of the public prosecutor, who prosecutes in the public interest, and the role of a victim's own lawyer, which is what the independent legal representation provisions are about. But the role of a public prosecutor is to prosecute in the public interest. And in my view, the public interest is a wide concept. And within that, it must mean that victims who come to court to give evidence in these very difficult cases are properly supported. And that proper support must be through the sort of engagement that you highlighted, the evidence sessions indicated was necessary. Support in the pre-trial process, support in deciding how you're going to give your evidence, one of the most important decisions in the case, support in giving your evidence and preparing the victim for court, and support thereafter in the form of meetings and discussions about the case. And we do all of these things as much as we possibly can do, but we don't do it in all our cases because we simply do not have the resource. You can understand that if there are many, many cases listed for trial, and some of these are floating trials, we don't know the date that they're going to start on, it's very, very challenging to organise a rota that means all these individuals who come into court get the sort of support that they need. And I would like to be able to do more. And I did highlight some of the work that I've done as Lord Advocate, but one of the most exciting things that we're doing, and I think is going to hopefully lead to significant transformation, is the review that Suzanne Tanner's doing. It is the most significant review that's ever been undertaken into the work of sexual crime in Crown Office, and I'm sure that you'll hear more about it. But just to give you the sense of this, it was commissioned by me at the end of 2021, not long after I was appointed, and the terms of reference were agreed with me. They're broad and have demanded a large-scale inquiry using mixed methods of approach to evidence gathering, including seeking personal views from over 400 contributors in individual interviews, group interviews, focus groups, questionnaires, roundtable events to consider proposed recommendations. And there has been an enormous engagement with those within the Crown Office and Prosecutor's Fiscal Service about these types of cases. And there'll be very significant recommendations, I think, coming from the review. And I'm very excited about it. I think it will highlight everything that I've ever spoken about in relation to the challenges with these cases and what we don't get right at the moment.
Thank you. So just on the point that Russell Finlay raised about legislation, you seem to be doing an awful lot of work already. Mm. So is the reason that we require the legislation because along with that comes a financial memorandum that will actually give you resources to be able to implement it?
I think that's a very big part of it, Ms Dowie. I think that's a very important point that you make. This doesn't come without the need for significant resource. And I think that we're here today discussing this issue because it has been a terrible burden on the Crown Office and Prosecutor Fiscal Service for as long as I possibly can remember. And we want to make it better. And in order to make it better, we need to change things. And as part of the change, it does mean a recognition that we try to do all that we can do at the moment, but we can't do everything. And you see that in the varying reports that you got from victims who came to give evidence here. Some of what they spoke about is just unacceptable. Some of it was really encouraging, particularly Miss Ashby's experience in 2023. There's a lot that needs to be done to be able to provide what Miss Ashby had to every victim. And not every victim's the same. They all need to have their needs recognised, and as far as possible, bespoke packages of support delivered to ensure that they give their best evidence and they have a good experience of the system that is just not delivering at the moment.
Okay, final quick question. So with the current and expected future resources, do you think that trauma-informed practices can be implemented meaningfully?
I think the indication in our response to the financial memorandum was that it would need further resource in order to deliver on the training that was necessary for trauma-informed practice. I think Ms Buchan gave evidence about that before. I have the figure. I think it's something in the region of 600,000. Yes, so what resources are required? So I think we've previously given evidence that the resource required would exceed current resource provision, that Currently, we can advise that the cost to the Crown for all existing staff to undertake one day of training in relation to trauma-informed practice would be £600,000 if the resource requirement fell within 2023 to 2024. Should the requirement fall in future years, an adjustment would be appropriate. Pay award uplifts and inflationary rises would be required to be applied. So the Crown Office anticipate incurring costs from developing and delivering training in trauma-informed practice with their staff. As with other agencies, irrespective of the proposals of the Bill, we've already committed to the implementation to the skills framework, and we envisage adapting the framework to make them more trauma-informed, and again, that will have resource implications. So we can provide... I think all we can say is that we can do an existing budget.
Yeah, thank you. Thanks.
Okay, thank you. John Swinney, followed by Rona McKay.
Thank you, Convener. Lord Advocate, I wonder if I could ask some questions in relation to Part 4, particularly in relation to the composition of juries. And I wonder if you would share with the committee any issues that you believe the committee needs to be mindful of in the consideration of the parts of the Bill that relate to the change to the jury majority provisions away from a simple majority to a two-thirds majority. Mm. What considerations should the committee have about that particular proposal?
So, in my view, I consider that the changes that are proposed will make it more difficult to get a conviction in the type of cases that we're talking about here today. And I think that we need to recognise that currently our system operates with interconnected concepts of three verdicts, corroboration, which are very important to understanding what needs to be considered when changes are being made. Our system requires corroboration, unlike the system in England and Wales, for example. So I think that my concern, and indeed the Crown Office's concern, is that the proposals only legislate for a guilty verdict to require the identified two-third majority, and no similar requirement is imposed in relation to the return of a not guilty verdict. In other jurisdictions that operate a qualified majority or a requirement for unanimity, this applies to the returning of both guilty and not guilty verdicts. And the provisions in Scotland then would be unique in requiring only a majority for guilty verdicts. So I think previously in evidence sessions and in written submissions, the Crown identified the potentially unsatisfactory situation where a jury may reach a decision where seven of the jury returned a verdict of guilty and five returned a not guilty verdict, but in the absence of a requirement for a majority of not guilty to be returned, a not guilty verdict would result, although the minority of the jury reached this verdict. So I suggest that this situation is more than undesirable than the existing difficulties caused by the not proven verdict, and would be unsatisfactory for both the accused and the complainer. Whilst the individual verdict of each juror is not provided at the end of a trial, and there's no requirement to establish the number of each verdict reached by the jury beyond whether a verdict is unanimous or by a majority, experience has shown that juries will often return to the court seeking guidance as to what verdict should be returned when the required majority has not been reached. That's seen often when juries seek guidance where, for example, 8 votes have not been reached. There are 7 for guilty, 5 for not guilty, and 3 for not proven. And it's anticipated that notwithstanding clear directions from presiding judge and sheriffs, juries under the proposed system may seek guidance from the court where the verdicts returned are 7 guilty and 5 not guilty, or where the jury is split 6-6. So the Crown's position to this committee is that if Parliament's considering changing the majority, it might be worth considering whether a majority should remain for both guilty and not guilty verdicts, and whether there should be a provision for retrial.
Thank you, Lord Advocate. It's a very substantial and important answer that you've provided the committee in that respect. I wonder if I can explore a couple of details about the answer. The first is in relation to the question that you raise, understandably, about in, for example, a 12-member jury and the decision is 7-5, so the two-thirds majority under the proposals of this bill are not reached. I wonder if you could spell out to the committee what you consider, and the Crown considers, to be the dangers for public confidence in the criminal justice system as a consequence of the fact that for simple majorities have resulted in convictions within the Scottish courts, we would suddenly be embarking on a position which would have a simple majority not being good enough, but a majority still being there. I wonder what the Crown's thoughts are on that, on the implications for public confidence in the criminal justice system.
I think it would erode public confidence in the justice system to go ahead with the two-thirds majority proposal without the sort of safeguards that the Crown are asking for, which is a provision for retrial. And currently, the system that we operate is one of a simple majority, but it's a system where there's 15 jurors and 53% of the jury's verdict for guilty is required in order to return a guilty verdict. We're going to be increasing the percentage required of that jury for a guilty verdict, and we're going to be in a situation where, even where a majority hasn't come down in favour of a guilty verdict, there's still within a jury five people who've been voting for guilty. There's not the majority in favour of five people have been voting for guilty. There's not the majority required, and the case just no longer continues. The case is lost, and it would just be the wrong way to proceed. We've very profound concerns about what's proposed, for the reasons that have been set down in our written submissions and in the evidence previously given.
Thank you, Lord Advocate. My last question relates to a comment you made about the fact that Scotland would be in a unique position if we were to embark on these proposals. And, of course, Scotland is in a rather unique position just now because we have the three verdict situation. So I'm not yet persuaded that replacing one unique situation with another unique situation is much of a step forward in that respect, particularly given the serious issues that you have placed on the record today, Lord Advocate. I wonder if you could perhaps share with the committee what you consider, given your formidable a track record in relation to the prosecution of crimes in this area that is of concern to the committee, of the standard and the scale of challenge that corroboration puts into the prosecution of crimes of this nature as a unique feature of the Scottish criminal justice system, to explain to the committee comparatively how much greater the hurdle is to get a conviction because of corroboration, which is not being in any way challenged or changed by this legislation. How high is the hurdle because of corroboration that needs to be overcome? And what do we need to be mindful of in addressing the implications of the height of that hurdle in the sensitive decision we have to comment on to Parliament in this respect?
So, The issue in around corroboration is a matter that this Parliament has looked at before. There's been previous Lord Carlow's review, and is an issue that I know many survivors in relation to sexual crime talk about as being a real a barrier to justice. And I think in the judiciary's response to the consultation exercise, they moved away from previous opposition to removal of corroboration to supporting removal of corroboration because they described it just as such a barrier to justice. But there's very profound issues in and around the rules of corroboration that aren't part of what this committee is looking at. But from the perspective of prosecutors, in every case, we have to look to see whether or not there's corroboration. And in cases of sexual crime, which are often committed in clandestine circumstances, we struggle to identify corroborative evidence because it is the type of case that's committed in secret between the assailant and the victim, and there's not very often eyewitnesses. So there's always the challenge in these cases to look for and find corroboration. I think the committee knows a little bit about the Lord Advocate's reference that I took that overturned the long-standing authority of Smith against Lees, which was a case from the 1990s that set down the rules that for corroboration in cases of sexual crime, you're required to prove each element of the crime. That is, the accused committed the crime, the accused was responsible, and that the complainer was sexually assaulted, and in a case of rape that she was penetrated. And these separate elements of the crime required corroboration, penetration, lack of consent, identification of the accused. The Lord Advocate's reference that I took, which was a big part of why I took the role of Lord Advocate in the first place, challenged that authority and re-looked again at all the historical authorities, the institutional writers, and the Court of Appeal overturned the 5-judge bench decision in Smith against Lees and ruled that in cases of sexual crime, and indeed it relates to other cases, but in cases of sexual crime, all you need is evidence that the crime was committed and the accused committed it, and you needed corroboration of the fact that the crime was committed and the accused committed it. So in relation to corroboration of the crime now, we look to the evidence of the complainer, and we still have to find independent evidence that supports her account. And so, for example, in Smith against Lees, it was ruled that distress only corroborated lack of consent. But the new ruling, which overturns Smith against Lees, says that distress corroborates the complainer's account of the fact that she was sexually assaulted and the manner in which she was assaulted. And so previous understanding of the need for separate corroboration of penetration was ruled as a misunderstanding and a wrong application of the law. But as a long answer to your question, Mr. Swinney, it's the biggest challenge for prosecutors in the prosecution of these types of crime to obtain corroboration.
So, if I just may ask one very brief final question. Would it be fair for the committee to assume, Lord Advocate, that your view would be that were we to enact the changes to the jury majority provision, we would be making the challenge of securing convictions greater, given that your success with the Lord Advocate's reference has improved the prospects and that it's almost, it could be characterised as one step forward and two steps back?
I think your characterisation is sound. We have profound concerns about it, and we've provided submissions given our concerns, and to ensure consistency with other jurisdictions that require unanimity or a qualified majority, there should be provisions for the Crown to seek the authority of the court for a retrial where a majority is not reached. These provisions are not unknown in Scots law. We have, for example, double jeopardy provisions, and we have the power of the appeal court to order fresh prosecutions. But fundamentally, if you're going to increase the percentage of individuals that you require for a verdict of a guilty vote, you are going to make it far more challenging to secure a guilty verdict in a system that requires corroboration.
Thank you. Thank you.
Just got about 10 minutes left, so I'm going to bring in Rona Mackay.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Lord Advocate. Just really following on from John Swinney's line of questioning, you previously gave evidence to say that only 20% of single rape cases were prosecuted, went on for convictions. Do you think the removal of, if you set aside corroboration because it's not in the bill, would the removal of not proven improve that situation, do you think?
I just don't know the answer to that question. What I know is that juries are directed currently that not proven and not guilty are both verdicts of acquittal. I know that there's discussion in some cases and case law in around sheriffs and judges saying to juries, well, it's just a different emphasis, perhaps. But the fundamental point is it's a verdict of acquittal, and juries know that. Yes. So I can't honestly say, but I think we could reasonably deduce from the fact that juries are told their verdicts of acquittal, it might make no difference at all.
So if I'm understanding correctly, in terms of not proven, I think what you're saying is if we get the balance right with regard to jury size and majority, it would work. And your point about retrials, would that not be an enormous burden on an already overcrowded court system?
Well, so So, of course, we operate, Crown operates within the structure of a criminal justice system that's created and determined by the legislature. But there are some potential consequences of the proposed changes and the ancillary reforms that were indicated necessary following the removal of a not proven verdict. We urged caution in the extrapolation of previous research in suggesting that the removal of the not proven verdict would require to be balanced by an increase in majority required for a guilty verdict. And we indicated it was unclear why the removal of not proven would result in an increase in conviction rates. And we think that there's no logical argument that can be made that a properly directed juror who's discharging their oath would, after hearing evidence, find that the case has not been proved beyond reasonable doubt and returned a not proven verdict in the free verdict system, would, on hearing the same evidence, decide that the case has now been proved and return a guilty verdict in a two-verdict system. That's the concern. I recognise the point that you make about provisions for retrial, but my point is, if you're going to go with the proposals, you have to be able to provide some form of safeguard for the situation that will arise where you have a 7-5 split in a jury. And my submission is it would be appropriate that following the failure of a jury to reach the required majority, the Crown could seek the authority of the court to re-raise proceedings. It wouldn't be an automatic right to re-raise and would give careful consideration to the issue, including the public interest in undertaking a second trial, and the court would have to be satisfied as to the appropriateness of granting any such application. And I think that we can take some confidence from the way in which this works in England, because research indicates that hung juries are about 1%, and I think evidence was given that that might include a single charge amongst other charges. However, it could be that the murder charge in an indictment of smaller assault, so it might be a significant charge, And even at the rate of 1%, that would still amount to somewhere in the region of 20 trials per annum, based on current projections of 2,100 jury trials in which evidence is being led in the period 23 to 24. So I don't think it would place the burden on the system that is that has been highlighted.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay, so I'm assuming that's not a road you would want to go down anyway, if we could get the balance right with
yes.
what you consider to be a fair yeah. jury size.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, but I think that everything's so interconnected, and I think that's often what has always been said, that the whole system is balanced out mm-hmm. by different checks and balances, mm-hmm. and we've inherited our system from our forefathers, and we've been working in it, mm-hmm. but it's only right that you look to change,
yeah.
and it's only right that you challenge what's gone before and ask the question, is it right? And in doing that, recognise the strengths of some of what's gone before, mm-hmm. in addition to recognising some of the weaknesses that we deal with day and daily, and we've got to change.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. And we're going to bring in Fulton McGregor. We're just coming up to time, so if I can ask you to be brief, please.
Yeah, thanks, Convener, and good morning to the Lord Advocate. It is remaining on part four, and I think you have given a very fulsome response to part four. So it will be a very brief question. I know that this is a question for the Scottish Government, primarily, not yourself, but I just wanted to know your views on why you think these proposals have been put to us. What I'm trying to understand is where has this link came from between getting rid of not proven and changing the jury size? Is some, I mean, I'm sure the government won't call it this, but it's some sort of compromise almost. Mm. And that's just my words. That's nobody else's words, not the committee or the government's. But I'm just trying to understand where you think this might have came from, because every witness we're asking doesn't seem to have an answer.
So I come here as the Lord Advocate, the independent head of Prosecution Service, and responsible for the investigation of deaths in Scotland. I am not an elected Member of Parliament. I am not involved in the development of policy, which is a matter for the legislature of an executive of the day. It's often said the Lord Advocate is the legal advisor to the government on legal issues, and the separate role of independent head. And that is genuinely the approach, and the development of policy is a matter for the Cabinet Secretary of Justice and the elected parliamentarians and the elected parliament, the elected party in power of the day. It is not for me to comment on, and I would never do that, because I protect the integrity of my office at all costs, and I'm not going to be drawn on that question. I can't answer it.
Okay, apologies for asking that manner. Well, what I was more thinking was, do you see any benefits, if you like, from if we remove not proven to changing the jury sizes? I know you spoke clearly about the jury sizes, but if not proven is to be removed, do you think something needs to change with the jury size? Or I suppose what I'm asking is, would you rather leave the jury sizes as they are?
So I think the question about not proven is, I think, whether you remove it or not. So I think if you remove not proven, I've been asked, do you think that would mean more verdicts of guilty? That's the question. I think I said, I just don't know the answer to that. But I think it's reasonable to suggest that if juries have reached the stage where they're not satisfied of the guilt of an individual beyond reasonable doubt, whether they characterise that in their own mind as not guilty or not proven, you're not going to get over the hurdle and get to a guilty verdict. So that's my answer to not proven. My answer to the changes in relation to the jury size and the changes to majority are that they are very concerning, and they would, to my mind, make it far more difficult to achieve a conviction in the type of cases that we are so concerned with here. We know that, for example, in the single accused acquaintance-type rape cases, that the current level of conviction rate disguises the very low level of conviction rates in these types of cases. And it's, I think one of the young women who spoke to you about her experience was that even in her case, where she had a recording of an admission by the accused to the offence, that it was only a majority verdict. And I think she echoes some of what I'm saying today. I think she gave a very powerful evidence on that.
Yeah, I agree. Thanks a lot.
OK, yeah. Thank you. As ever, I've got a number of members would like to come in with supplementary questions. This is a really important part of our bill. So I'm going to bring in Pauline McNeill, then John Swinney, and ask you to be as brief as possible.
It was just on a specific point, Lord Advocate, which I think you've given the committee a lot of food for consideration here in relation to the implications of a 7-5, not a two-thirds majority. Mm-hmm. So, and you'd said as previous to the committee that therefore you thought the Crown should have the, not an automatic right, but a right. I just wondered if you agreed that there needs to be some clear rules around this, or transparency on what the grounds would be.
Mm-hmm.
You are obviously naturally going to be pressurised by families and victims in every case, I would have thought, to use that. So I just wondered if you thought there should be some consideration, should the Crown, or should the Parliament legislate for a retrial in those circumstances?
Mm-hmm. I think that that would be protected by the fact it wouldn't be an automatic right to re-raise proceedings, and that in any case careful consideration would be given by the Crown to the public interest in undertaking a second trial, and the court would have to be satisfied that it was appropriate of granting any such application. I think that if the committee were to be looking at that issue, it might very well be that we could be, you could be further informed by an exploration of the way in which that currently is undertaken in England and Wales. And there are numerous examples of cases that can be looked at where the Crown have gone back in England and Wales and sought a retrial. Just for example, a very high-profile case recently, the Lucy Letby case. Some of the charges were returned as guilty. Some of them the jury couldn't return a verdict on, and the Crown went again on those charges. But that was after very careful consideration. So if it would help the committee, the Crown could put in a further submission in and around the case law that's developed in England and Wales around the issue, and what might be the very significant issues that we'd look at in the context of our assessment of what is in the public interest. The question of what's in the public interest can encompass so many different things: the age of the case, the impact on the victim, the way that the evidence came out at trial. All these sorts of things might be relevant to the public interest
that would
decision.
Be very helpful. Thank you.
So
very
we
much.
Could do that. We could undertake to do that.
Thank you. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. I think John Swinney, you're happy not to come back in. Katie Clark.
Could I just ask one question, if that's okay? And I understand completely, Lord Advocate, that you're being asked to speculate. However, you have already indicated that you believe that if the proposals went ahead as currently proposed, they're likely to make it more difficult to get convictions. So if it was the case that it was simply that the not proven verdict was to be abolished with no change in jury size and no change in majority, what would your view be on the likely impact on convictions? And I appreciate I am asking you to speculate.
So I would speculate that just by removing the not proven verdict and retaining everything as it is, it would still be very challenging to get convictions in the type of cases that we're concerned with today. But I don't think it would... What would change the rate of convictions, in my view, would one very significant issue would be the far better support that you give to victims and witnesses coming to court. If you have a better prepared victim, if they're ready for court, if they're prepared for the court process and they have the confidence to deal with it and the confidence in the system and those who are involved in eliciting their evidence and taking the case to court are properly informed in terms of trauma-informed practice, that, to my mind, would be one of the biggest and most significant improvements in what we do. Okay. And I think that that would really help, because my own experience is the better prepared you are for anything in life that requires you to perform, mm-hmm. to give a talk about, if you're interviewed for a job, if you have to come to a committee room at the Parliament to give evidence, if you're prepped, you're better. Mm-hmm. You're more confident. You're prepared. Your answers are prepared. And that, to me, that to my mind, is the single biggest improvement that we could make. And I took up this job to try and make that difference. Mm-hmm. That's why I'm the Lord Advocate, mm-hmm. to make this change.
Okay, thank you.
And everything that I've done since my appointment, from the ordering of the review, to taking the Lord Advocate's reference, to going out and speaking to young fiscals, speaking to members of the senior staff, encouraging a change in culture and embedding in people a desire to secure justice for victims in these types of cases, is what I've been about. And I would really like to see that very significant improvement in this time that I have in my time in office.
Okay, thank you very much on that positive note. Can I thank you, Lord Advocate, for joining us this morning? It's been immensely helpful. And we'll now have a short suspension just to allow for a changeover of witnesses. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. And I would now like to welcome our second panel for today. So can I welcome the Right Honourable Lord Matthews, Senator of the College of Justice, and Sheriff Andrew Cubie, Sheriff of Glasgow and Strathkelvin, Appeal Sheriff and Temporary High Court Judge. So welcome to you both, and we're very grateful that you've been able to give up time and join us this morning. So I intend to allow up to 90 minutes for this panel, and I propose that we focus our questions initially on the proposal for a new sexual offences court before moving on to jury majorities, the proposals for a pilot for judge-led trials in certain rape cases, and the proposals for independent legal representation for complainers, and finally, anonymity for victims of sexual offences. So I understand that neither of our witnesses wish to make an opening statement. So if I may, I'll just move straight to questions and open up with a general question, a general couple of questions. The first is on the proposals around the specialist sexual offences court. So if I can maybe just come to Lord Matthews first and then Sheriff Cubie. So I wonder if we can just ask you what your views are on the or what the views of the judiciary are on the idea of creating a specialist sexual offences court. Is this supported? And if so, why? So, Lord Matthews.
Thank you. Well, I'm glad you took out reference to my views, because I'm not here to represent my own views, as you know. The judiciary are broadly speaking, in favour of the proposal for a sexual offences court. We agree with the thinking, the conclusions drawn by Lady Dorian's review group for the various reasons which she has set out, because despite a number of statutory interventions over the years and the best efforts of everyone involved, change has been glacial and we've not been able to effect the cultural change which we think is needed, because reform has been piecemeal and we need to get away from the practices rooted in the Victorian era and develop a modern approach. As you know, there have been a number of statutory interventions over the years, from 1985, 95, 2002, 2004, 2014, 2000, and so on. And each of these has brought about a useful change, but a piecemeal change. So we think it's important that we start with a clean slate as well. If we had a clean slate, we wouldn't invent the court that we've got now, I don't think. A specialist court would have its own rules and procedure, albeit we start off, I think, with the practices and the rules for the High Court. I think as time goes on, these will be refined, I hope, and developed. And the court would be trauma-informed, all the practitioners in it, the judiciary, the clerks, everyone would be trauma-informed. Specially trained personnel can be expected to develop the best practice, both at pre-trial stage and during the taking of evidence. And I think we've recognised the benefits of specialism in a number of areas. It can increase efficiency, reduce trauma. We've had the experience of the preliminary hearing judges, a small coterie of judges who have developed best practice in preliminary hearings, as opposed to the approach before when anyone could, not anyone, but there was not a consistency of approach, I think, in PHs before. Example, we've heard that some lawyers, and you've heard, I think, some lawyers have not understood the rape shield legislation. Perhaps some judges haven't understood it or followed it properly. And the appeal court has, in recent years, taken very great steps to explain exactly what the rape shield legislation means. And I think a small cohort of specialist judges, well, a big cohort of specialist judges in the sexual offences court will understand that better. Than people who are just flitting in and out, as it were, of these types of cases. In my own experience, I was a sheriff in Glasgow, and we started off the Glasgow Drug Court. We saw how that worked, a specialist court. Domestic abuse courts, particularly, have been shown to work. Different types of crime affect perpetrators and victims in different ways, and I think call for different approaches. The Human Rights Act, when it came in, brought about a culture change. We looked at things from a completely different lens. And I think consistency can be delivered in a specialist court the way it's not been done so far. For example, one idea that just came to me a while ago was that instead of putting the defence case to a witness as often as done, you did this, you did that, the answer is always no. And you wonder, what's the point of doing that? That just increases the trauma. So it may be the practical development of not having to do that, for example. That's just one area where a new court could start off with a clean slate and not go down that sort of route. So generally, a court with national jurisdiction separate from the High Court should be able to make greater and more efficient use of the court, the state and the judiciary. So we are, as I think from all that, you can see we're in favour of it.
Thank you very much, Lord Matthews. I mean, a very comprehensive and well sort of articulated position, so thank you. So I'll just bring in Sheriff Cuby just on that same question.
Thank you, Convener. You'll be aware from the consultation that the Sheriffs and some of the Sheriffs Association made no comment about the policy choice of a sexual offences court. But I associate myself with what Lord Matthews has said. The tinkering with existing courts, I think, would not necessarily achieve the kind of impetus that a new discrete court would have in relation to having a trauma-informed, complainer-centred set of procedures which can evolve in a more focused way, given the focus of the court. Unless there are any particular questions arising from what Lord Matthews has said, I associate myself with what's been said. I have had experience as a specialist sheriff in both the domestic abuse and the family court, and I can speak of the particular benefits of specialisation and expertise and the consistency that arises from specialisation, which I think would be one of the benefits of a sexual offences court, as I say, with its own discrete jurisdiction.
Right. Thanks very much. That's helpful. I wonder if I can just ask a follow-up question. I'll come back to yourself, Lord Matthews. And again, I'm interested in the sort of views of the judiciary on what the Scottish Government is proposing in terms of the new court and how it might operate, what that would look like, given that it's not strictly being proposed as a new division of the High Court?
Well, I think in terms of Lady Dorian's review, she saw this as, I think, a separate court. It's not just it's a particular court, not just regarded as a High Court sexual offences division or anything like that. Yeah. It would be a separate court using the same estate as we have at the moment and the same judiciary made up of judges and sheriffs. Probably judges, sheriffs who normally would sit as temporary judges as well, I would think. So to that extent, there would be no moving around of building new buildings or anything like that, at least not in the initial stages, I don't think. It may be that some of the estate might have to be adapted in due course if, for example, that there was a problem with complainers coming across the accused as they walked into the building, that kind of thing. But an awful lot of the estate has been modernised in any event. Places like Inverness and the Salt Market and that kind of place do have separate buildings. Aberdeen is not ideal, but these things are a matter that can be looked at and addressed. I think that as far as the court itself is concerned, I'd imagine that it would wigs and gowns and the normal formal processes of a court would be there, but we would hope that the evidence in the court would not consist of normally the complainer giving evidence at all in the court, because we're in favour of the use of pre-recorded evidence, which I think would be a crucial part of this if it's going to succeed.
Okay, thank you. I don't know if Sheriff Cuby, you want to add anything just on that before I open it up to members?
I don't think so, because I think it's anticipated the same estate will be used. Lord Matthews talked about the potential problem of complainers seeing accused. That will be less of an issue when the complainer's evidence is captured in advance. So some of the issues in terms of the state and the buildings and so on are less likely to be a problem in circumstances when complainers won't be there on the day of the trial, their evidence having been recorded at an earlier stage. But I don't think it's anticipated that a new court building will be required or much modification to the existing estate where trials with juries already take place all over the country.
Okay, thank you. And I know members will want to come back and look at this a lot more closely. So I'm going to bring in Rona Mackay, then Pauline McNeill.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. Just on the last point, this before I ask my question really about pre-recorded evidence, We've heard from survivors saying that they would like to have the choice. Some preferred. Would you agree that they should
have the choice?
They have
to have a choice. Yes. I think the bill provides for that.
So in the new court, it wouldn't be mandatory that they had to do that if they chose not to.
We can't force it on them. I mean, I've been involved in that case where the complainant says, "I didn't want this. I didn't want this. I'd rather have a screen, or I don't want a screen." Sure, and I said, "Right, who said you had to have it?"
No, that's fine. I just wanted to.
No, there won't be any issue with that. But they'll have to be told, obviously.
It can be
daunting. Uh-huh. I've seen cases where people want to come in.
Yeah.
And they go in, and then they go, "Oh God, I don't want to be here. I want to go."
Yeah, yeah. Uh-huh.
Which is fine. We can deal with that as well.
Yeah, that's great.
There's statutory provision for variation of special measures at any time, depending on the view of the complainer. Mm-hmm. As has been recognised, sometimes the complainer will think they want to give evidence in court and change their mind. Mm-hmm. Other times they'll come to give evidence remotely and decide they want to go into court. Mm-hmm. And the variation of any special measures can be made at any time.
Thank you. I'm sure
that will be the same.
Thanks for that.
It's got to be an informed choice as well.
So my question really is that the bill provides that judges of sexual offences court would be appointed for a period set by the Lord Justice General, who would also have the power to remove them. So I wanted to hear your thoughts on that. And we heard evidence from the Faculty of Advocates last week who were casting doubt on the seniority of the judges and their experience in this court, and they were, you know, a bit dubious about that. I wonder if you could maybe set out how that would work in practice, and I think it's all related to the fear that a sexual offences court could be downgraded from a high court when rape's involved.
Well, as far as the appointment of judges is concerned, that's a matter for the Lord Justice General rather than me. I can't imagine there'd be any issue about the seniority of the judges. The Lord Justice General is not in the business of appointing people who are not senior enough to do the job. And I don't think that can be said. Judges themselves, senators, will have been appointed as judges through the normal processes. There'd be people of experience and skill over the years, and the sheriffs are appointed to the temporary judges' posts are also people of vast experience and skill. I'm not sure where the faculty is coming from in that regard, but generally speaking, the appointment of judges is a matter which is done on the basis of skill and experience. I'm struggling to see where the Faculty of Advocates concern arises from.
They were very insistent on that, and I was struggling as well. That's why I'm keen to ask you both your views. Sheriff Cuby, do you have a view on that?
I think, again, I would associate myself with Lord Matthews. I know that in both the Senator's response and the Sheriff's and Summary Sheriff's Association response, there was some concern about the tenure of any judges that were appointed and the mode of appointment, which I think has been described as cumbersome, and the mode of removal. So it might be preferable to have some level of tenure and for there to be more formality. But given the model we already have of the appointment of temporary judges, which doesn't seem to have given rise to any specific concerns about that, it is a little bit difficult to understand why there's now thought to be a difficulty in relation to the appointment. But it will remain, as Lord Matthews has said, in the control of the senior judiciary. And while there might be some matters raised in the responses in relation to appointment, removal and tenure, I think these are matters that I don't think it would be appropriate for me to comment on, other than to say it's difficult to see what the particular grounds are that would give rise to disquiet about appointments to the Sexual Offences Court, mm-hmm. as opposed to, for example, to the role of a temporary judge.
Sure. And do you have any concerns about any perception that the Sexual Offences Court would be, you know, downgraded, less, shall we say, sombre and serious than the High Court, which traditionally obviously has always dealt with rape and murder cases?
No, I think the Lord Advocate made the point in her earlier evidence session that in the Sheriff Court, solemn cases at jury level, some very serious crimes are dealt with. So I have no reservations about that, any degree of solemnity or downgrading as a result of characterising some offences as being part of the Sexual Offences Court. Mm-hmm.
Matthews? I don't have any views about that. I mean, when it comes to sentencing, for example, as you know, our suggestion, or Lady Dorian's suggestion, with which we agreed, was there should be a limit up to 10 years, but I think the bill doesn't have that limit. It's the same sentencing powers as the High Court. And that's a matter, obviously, for Parliament to decide.
Sure.
But I don't think there's a downgrading. I think the... what we have is, in fact, an upgrading, if you like, by giving these particular cases a special court to deal with them, rather than simply being part of the day-to-day business of the High Court. So I wouldn't agree with that. The formality of the court would be exactly the same, I would have thought, as the High Court. There's no reason to think otherwise, except I would hope that it would be, while still adversarial, it might, if the witness is in the court or whether the witness is giving evidence in commission, it would be perhaps less confrontational. Sure. I would hope that would be the case.
Thank you. Appreciate that. Thank you.
Thank you. Pauline McNeill, followed by Russell Finlay.
Thank you. Good morning. Can I start by asking you, Lord Matthews, just about one point you made in answer to my colleague about not putting the accused statement to the victim because it always results in an answer of no.
Yeah,
so the committee have had a lot of exchanges around the, I suppose, the culture of the defence, some defence counsel, in the way they question victims. Would you have to agree that with the defence's solicitors in order not to have to put that? How would that operate?
I think what we do nowadays, where a commission is to be fixed, we have a checklist which we go through at the preliminary hearing. And one of the questions there is, to what extent is it necessary to put the defence case? The English have more experience of this than we do. I don't know how it developed in Scotland, that the idea of you must put the defence case to give the witness an opportunity to comment. But it's pretty obvious in most cases that what the defence, if the defence are going to say that you did this and you did that, we know fine exactly what the witness is going to say and what she would say where she asked about it. So I think we have to bring people on board so we know in advance that we can discuss at a preliminary hearing whether it needs to be done. The Crown, I think, quite content not to do it. The thinking behind it, I think, was that if a witness went into the witness box and said X, Y, Z and was not asked about something else, then the accused went in and said it without this having been put to the complainer. The first question the Crown would ask is, did you tell your counsel that? Because, or have you just made it up? Whatever the answer to that was, it was generally a reasonably cheap shot because most of the time I don't think it had much effect. And I think that was why people did it, to make sure they couldn't be criticised in that way. But if it was understood they didn't have to do it, then that sort of thing wouldn't come into the equation. But I think people do get upset, and I've seen them get upset when they're asked about things which they say didn't happen. And why are you asking me this? I've already told you what happened. Why are you asking me about this which didn't happen? And this repetitive questioning about what you did that. And it gets them very upset. I've seen it, and I don't see the need for it. And I think if we can have a practice develop in this court where we don't have to do that, and people understand that nothing's going to be made of it, then I think it would be a good thing. And it would decrease the length of any cross-examination as well.
Thank you very much. So my next set of questions are obviously about the specialist court, and your evidence is really helpful. And, you know, if we get this right, it could be transformational. But you'll be aware that the provisions in the legislation do not mirror Lady Dorian's recommendations in a number of ways. So the sentencing powers are the same as the High Court, but it is not the High Court. My personal view is that what we are reading in the legislation is not what Lady Dorian envisaged, because rights of audience will change, and there's this really oddity, in my opinion, of murder being a plea to the crown of as a sexual element could be tried in the specialist court or the High Court, which doesn't seem to me to be any real need for, and you've referenced it in your submission. So my question is, do you think the government have thrown the baby out with the bathwater here, where there seemed to be a consensus around the need for a specialist court being a parallel court to the High Court, but what we're seeing in this legislation does not mirror that at all?
Oh, I'm not going to make any comments on what the government has or hasn't done. Good try. But what I will say is that the judges are of the view that murder should stay where it is in the highest court in the land. We think there are constitutional issues about having two courts with parallel jurisdiction running alongside each other. In a sense, what was the High Court for? Because it's not for treason or abuse of power by magistrates or arson in naval dockyards and any other things which don't happen anymore. So it does seem a bit constitutionally anomalous if we have two courts with the same powers. Now, but I'm not just saying this because we are High Court judges. We are just in there, as you know, for a short period of time as judges. It's been the Supreme Court in Scotland for centuries, and a major constitutional change like that to run another court is something which has to be thought out very, very carefully. I'm sure you will think of it very carefully, but we think murder should stay where it is because it is the most serious crime, and the High Court has to be the one that deals with that.
Thank you. So
whether the baby is in the bath or not, it's not something I want to discuss.
Thank you. But you say in your submission in relation to rights of audience that the requirements on legal practitioners should match those in the High Court,
yes,
and that legislation is required to be specifically trained. I think we're all agreed on that. Do you want to add anything?
Well, I think,
to that?
Yeah, I think, as I understand it, I think that everyone will be trauma informed, which is a new thing, which is good. But the people who appear in the Sexual Offences Court will either be advocates who have the rights of audience in the High Court anyway, or solicitor advocates who have rights of audience in the High Court, at least insofar. They'll have to be solicitor advocates or counsel if the case involves, as I understand it, rape or murder, if that's the case. Cases other than rape or murder, there won't be a requirement to have rights of audience in the High Court because you don't need rights of audience in the High Court anyway in the Sheriff Court if you're dealing with cases other than rape or murder. So I'm not convinced that there is a real change in the rights of audience. Mm.
I'm not sure myself, because not being a practitioner, it's what I'm trying to understand. Because if the specialist court would hear a whole range of cases, including rape, then that would mean that there would be specialist court, if it was parallel, to the High Court, let's say in Lady Dorian's, how she envisaged it. But the crimes that would be indicted in the specialist court would be crimes that previously would have been the High Court and the Sheriff Court. Not going to be some differences there?
Yes, well, you can have... The High Court can deal with any crime, but rape and murder would not previously have been in the Sheriff Court.
Uh-huh.
So if the indictment involves rape and or murder, then it will have to be someone who's got rights of audience in the High Court to deal
but
with.
For things that are... For crimes which are not rape or attempted rape, some of those cases would have been tried in the Sheriff Court.
Yes.
Yeah. But they will all come together in one specialist court. Is that
they will,
what you're understanding?
But I think the nature of the indictment will determine who can appear to defend it.
Okay. Is there some grey area around, so some cases which are not rape or attempted rape would still be indicted in the High Court if the Lord Advocate thought it was severe enough?
Yes, if someone has committed...
And would attract rights of audience, of counsel, are those cases potentially not provided for in relation to the specialist court because they're not ring-fenced by being represented by senior counsel or counsel in relation to rape? But Do you see where I'm going with this?
Sometimes you might have a case involving, I don't know, five or six episodes of attempted rape with different complainers. Now, the Crown would, in a case like that, normally put that into the High Court, where someone with rights of audience in the High Court would have to appear. Such a case could, in theory, go into the Sexual Offences Court if it's enacted in the current form. In a case like that, if the indictment did not include murder or rape, then someone who did not have rights of audience in the High Court could appear to defend that, as I understand the bill. Although it's obviously for the government to explain
that,
what the bill is.
Yeah,
but that's my understanding of the position. Whether that's a good thing or not is perhaps
not
that's for
my
me
understanding.
To say.
Thank you. And just finally, is it your position, as your submission, that the legislation should reflect Lady Dorian's recommendations, as they were?
That was the position of the sheriffs, the judges or the senators, yes.
Thank you. Just one quick question to Sheriff Cuby. In relation to tenure temporary judges, this point was made to us by Lady Dorian, but just as a layperson listening to that, I thought, well, temporary judges are temporary judges, they aren't permanent judges. So there is a difference between temporary judges and judges who have sat for many years as permanent judges in the High Court. When you say perhaps you need to look at the question of tenure, do you mean that there would be a fixed term so that the question of the independence of the judge and the appointment by the Lord President wouldn't be compromised?
Temporary judges receive a commission for a period of 5 years.
Right.
and that commission will automatically be renewed unless the temporary judge doesn't want it to be renewed, or unless there's some reason for it not to be renewed. So there's a degree of structure to that. Mm-hmm. And it was the absence of that, I think, that caused some concern in relation to the appointment. I wonder if I might say something in relation to Lord Matthews' answer to your first question about putting the defence case. I think it's important to recognise that the Act embodies a ground rules hearing in advance of any commission taking evidence. And that's a particular ring-fenced hearing simply about how the case is to be put to the complainer. And that can involve, and has done up till now in relation to children, actually seeing questions in advance and approving the questions and the questions being agreed. So there is a really good opportunity for the kind of concerns expressed about does the case need to be put, being looked at in detail by specialist judges in relation to the provision of a ground rules hearing, which will take place in advance of every commission, so that the kind of concerns expressed by complainers will be addressed in advance of any attempt to take evidence from complainers.
Thank you, that's very helpful. Thank you.
Okay,
very much.
Thank you. Russell Finlay, followed by John Swinney.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. I'm not sure if this is declarable, but I don't know. I've previously been a witness in Lord Matthews.
Good witness as well.
On three occasions, I might add, and no complaints at the trauma-informed experience. Okay, but Scotland,
I've got no complaints either.
No, good. Scotland is a very small place. Now, I wanted to ask about the Judy Lewis rape trial pilot initially. The submission from the senators to the committee says that there are, quote, different views held, yes, about this. And I just wonder if you can give me some sense of what the breakdown of those views, of their 36 senators, roughly what the proportions were.
I can't really. We didn't take a straw poll. All I can say is there are, I think, significant numbers on each side, if that helps.
Right.
So we didn't take, yeah, the numbers.
Was it a meeting or was it a form?
We had a meeting of a small committee, effectively, which in the first instance I was part of it, and the second instance when the bill came in I chaired it, of, I can't remember, half a dozen, five, six, something like that, judges. That was split. Yeah. And then the wider judiciary, we know, were split from some emails came in. So I don't know the numbers, I'm afraid.
The reason I ask is because it would help us, I think, understand the judicial thinking. And in respect of some of the other proposals, there is a lot more certainty or specific, yeah, detail about how the breakdown is. For example, the vast majority oppose not proven being retained.
Yes.
And then they provide, in the 2022 submission to the Scottish Government, it's a breakdown of 2-1 in respect of abolition of corroboration, which is no longer on the table. And then in your evidence earlier in respect of not hearing murder cases in the proposed new sex crime court, that seems to be unanimous.
Yes, as far as I can see.
Is that correct?
We don't have the problem. Is what we do normally with these is these are submitted, and anyone who wants to comment on it, because we put in two sets of answers, as it were, to the pilot court business. People may have been quite content with one or other of these answers, but not told us. So, yeah, it's hard to say what the figures are. And as far as murder, no one has, I don't think anyone's commented adversely by email or otherwise on what we say about murder and so on. So I think it's a fairly, if it's not unanimous, it's a fairly strong majority.
And that particular issue, which Polly McNeil's already spoken about, seems to be throughout the system, from, yeah, the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service to the Crown to the judiciary. Hmm. Yeah, okay. The proposed juryless rape trial seems to be the most contentious issue across the board. Now, last week we heard from Tony Lenihan, KC, who said, and if I can just quote him, "The fact that someone sits on the bench and takes the oath is not a guarantee of an absence of hidden bias or an absence of character defect. There are recent examples of people who've clearly smuggled character defects through the judicial appointments board for Scotland to end up on the bench." He was referring to a particular case of a sheriff who trains judges, who judges, and was appointed to do so by the First Minister, yet was latterly convicted of a criminal offence. He also says in his evidence, and I'll summarise here, that certain sheriffs are known to be either more likely to convict or more likely to impose lighter or heavier sentences. This appears to be, according to Mr. Lenihan, common knowledge amongst defence practitioners. So I suppose my question is, given those realities, is that not an argument against getting rid of juries?
The problem I've got is, as you know, the judges are divided, and that would no doubt be a concern of some of the judges who are against the pilot. I can't really do much more than point to our submissions to say that that may be a legitimate concern on part of some. Others would say everybody's got a character defect of some kind. Juries sure. may have been biased. Who knows what people bring into a decision-making process with them. I mean, we've all come across judges who we thought were biased or horrible or nasty.
Name names.
You probably could work out one or two when I was a boy appearing in front of them. But hopefully, I think this day and age is different. Even though I say so myself, when I was a boy going into the appeal court, for example, I used to have to get in with a tin hat. But nowadays, I think we are pussycats compared to what went on before. I think there's been a sea change because people were not prepared to put up with this sort of nonsense that we had to put up with when we were younger. But maybe it's a circular thing, and the next generation will be like the last one. I don't know, but I hope not. But I'm not sure I can go much beyond what we said, that there are views either way, and I'm not here to represent my own view. Mm. I obviously fall into one of these categories, so I can't say if it's not fair on someone who's not here from the other category to give his views. But these concerns are obviously legitimate.
And this is more of an observation and is an extension of the point made by Mr. Lennon. And the Senator's submissions already stated they're quite candid in accepting that the makeup of the senior judiciary is quite homogenous. And that in itself might be an argument for maintaining juries.
It's an argument which I think is made by the Senators themselves in the half of the argument which opposes it. But the thing, as far as that's concerned, though, the makeup of the judiciary is just a reflection of the pool from which the judiciary has been drawn. When I started as an advocate, I think there were 170 practising advocates, and about, memory serves, about 8 or 9 of those were women. And you look at the difference now, it's huge. It's just gradually working out that way. And I think there are, I may be wrong, but I think there are more women studying law now than men. So hopefully in the years to come, the figures will change and reflect better our society.
And also just picking up on your earlier answer about the evolution and the developments you've seen in your time on the bench and in the profession. We heard in the committee some evidence from rape complainers who all waived their anonymity because they were so moved to do so because of, in most cases, the poor experiences they suffered in respect of the justice system. I don't know if either of you saw this, but it really is worth seeking out the transcript. Much of what they seem to want from lawyers on all sides, whether it be Crown prosecutors, defence solicitors or members of the judiciary, is clear communication and essentially basic standards of respect and courtesy. And given that there have been so many horror stories spanning so many years, albeit you say things have improved significantly, I just wonder why that doesn't already happen, and why do we really need to legislate to ensure trauma-informed practice becomes standard?
But I think I know the case you're talking about, and I have read the transcripts as it happens in that case. I don't address individual cases, but generally speaking, things, as you say, have improved. We could, I suppose, move towards trying to do that in the High Court. The problem is, as I say, the first real effort to do something about it was in 1985, and here we are, 39 years later, and we're still talking about this. I think the time has come to wipe the slate clean, move on, and do it right. This is where we go from now on, with a clear statement of intent towards that. Because trying to change things gradually, as could be done in theory, has not worked so far, and I've got no real confidence that it would work. We'd go in courses and things like that, but we can't really control lawyers until they ask a question, then we can stop it. But the question's been asked. But we can. I think we're getting better at doing that, I have to say.
That's actually very pertinent to another point about the Section 275 applications. Some of the rape complainers said that in their cases, the defence hadn't formally sought a Section 275, but had effectively introduced character or sexual history evidence by stealth, by just stating it, and then the presiding judge has told the jury to disregard it, but the complainers have the view that the damage is already done. Do you see that happening frequently, and is there any sanction? Or do you think that if Section 275 and independent legal representation became enshrined in law, there'd be more likelihood of these types of tactics?
I haven't seen it personally to that extent. Some lawyers will obviously push the boat out as far as they can push it, but that's our job to stop that. I think nowadays it's not as bad. The 275 applications are all dealt with at preliminary hearings, so they know full well what can and cannot be asked. Any lawyer who tries to do something which has already been prohibited by the court or for which she's not asked permission should be slapped down immediately. I had a case involving one particular lawyer who put in a 275 application, and it was completely inadmissible, the evidence he sought to lead. And it was all against all principles which have been established in the Act and in recent authorities. And he told me that he didn't agree with the appeal court, and he was waiting for the day when all these convictions would be overturned and he could say, look, I started it. I told him this was wrong, shouldn't be doing it. I had a word with a faculty officer who spoke to him and told him to mend his ways for things he has done. So we can't, there are ways and means of telling lawyers not to do this. And at the end of the day, if they persisted in doing that kind of thing, they would be open to discipline.
Yeah, okay.
But I haven't seen it to that great extent. But I think, as I say, things are better now than they used to be.
Yeah.
But the case you're talking about was a particularly egregious example of a lawyer who didn't seem to want to do what he was told. But I won't say too much about that because it's a matter still being looked at.
Yeah. Thank you very much.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. John Swinney, followed by Sharon Dowie.
Thank you, convener. I hope I'm not going to follow the convener that I'm going to ask about part four, if that's okay. Thank you. I'm very interested in the contribution from the senators on the question of jury size.
Yeah.
And from the response to the government's consultation paper, the senators are not supportive of the changes to jury size. And I just wonder, Lord Matthews, if you could explain the senators' position and the concerns that they have about the proposals from the government.
I think what we thought was that a jury of 12, while it's obviously common in other countries, gives a greater opportunity for one particular juror, who may be recalcitrant in one way or another, to influence the jury. Where a jury falls shorter, it's reduced because of illness or whatever, we can go down to 12 anyway, as matters happen. If you start with a jury of 12 and you start reducing it to 9 or 10, the proposal in the bill, I think, is for something like 7, I think, out of 9 or 10 to become enough of a majority. That's quite a high hurdle, I would have thought, for the Crown to reach. And we thought that 10 out of 15 would be an appropriate majority for a verdict. We're not convinced that a case has been made out to change. I think that was the way we approached it.
I'm interested in the language that you used there, Lord Matthews, that that you felt this represented a greater hurdle for the Crown. And I'm interested in your perspective on a point that I put to the Lord Advocate earlier on, that which is about confidence in the criminal justice system, and Sheriff Cuby might want to comment on this as well, that today an individual can be found guilty on the basis of 8-7. Now, we never know that it's that, but that can happen.
Yeah.
We could find ourselves in a situation where a vote in a case is 7-5 in a jury of 12, but the person will be acquitted on the basis of the two-thirds majority threshold not being reached. And I'm interested in the view from the judiciary about your perspective on what that does to confidence in the criminal justice system, where for all of our time, a simple majority has been judged by members of the public to be sufficient to convict an individual of a crime, but suddenly a simple majority, well, an actual majority, is not going to be enough. It's going to have to be what I might call a supermajority. What does the judiciary think is the risk of that provision in relation to confidence in the criminal justice system?
It's not something we discussed as such, but as you know, the size of the majority is not something which is ever revealed, so we don't know what it is. The simple majority, which we've had hitherto, is one of 8 out of 15, and that's in a situation where there are 2 verdicts. So to that extent, we're moving on to a completely different playing field if we abolish not proven, as we're in favour of. So the idea of a simple... I know a lot of people don't have confidence in the notion of a simple majority where there are only 2 verdicts. I think there's a difference of approach there, and we're looking at it through a completely different lens. So I'm not sure if we're comparing like with like when we look at what would the bill would entail and what...
The submission from the senators goes on to make this point about a connection between the abolition of not proven and the change of jury size, and I'd like to come on to explore that in a moment. But I just wonder what the judiciary consider are the, you know, the points of anxiety about a simple majority on a 2 verdict trial, given that we are all told, and all the evidence that we've heard tells us this, that in effect we actually do have a 2 verdict trial already. It's just there's 2 variants of the not guilty side.
Logically, that is the case, but it's almost as difficult as trying to explain what not proven actually means. The idea that there are 2 acquittal verdicts has always been seen as the sort of counterbalance to the simple majority. Whether that's right logically is debatable, but nonetheless, some people will go for not proven as opposed to not guilty, and where they don't have the choice of that, it becomes a stark choice between 2 verdicts. Therefore, if you have a simple majority in that, let's say 1 vote swing either way, it's quite probably, it may be difficult to say that this case has been proved beyond reasonable doubt when so many people out of that jury have found that there is a reasonable doubt and are not satisfied. Why should it, how can it possibly be said that this is a safe conviction, as well, to use an English phrase? And so that is the anxiety, which is why we're a bit concerned about a majority of 1 in these cases. We've said, I think, that we wanted to see 10 out of 10, 2/3 majority, as it were, rather a simple one. Mm-hmm. We think that perhaps relieves the anxiety that any 1 vote can sway this.
So the position of the judiciary would be that if we were abolishing not proven, we should retain 15 as the jury size, and a threshold of 10 should be arrived at for conviction.
That was the thing. It's very much a policy matter, obviously, at the end of the day, what size the jury verdict is. But that was the figure we arrived at. When you look at England, for example, they require, I think, unanimity at first, and then the judge can tell them we'll take a majority of whatever, 10-2 or whatever. We don't want to go down that route of having to explain to the jury that you've got so long, and then I'll tell you you don't need to be unanimous. But I think with where we have just 2 verdicts, a simple majority of where 1 vote can swing it, it just doesn't strike us as being right somehow, because of the anxiety that it seems to indicate that a reasonable doubt has played a very big part in the minds of a very large minority of the jury. But as I say, we don't know what the majority is in any particular case, but we do know that potentially is the position. That's only 1 vote.
Okay, thank you. I wonder if Sheriff Cuby has any perspective on these questions as well.
I don't think of anything to add. I actually jotted down when Lord Narthus was speaking that the simple majority was seen to be counterbalanced by the two alternative verdicts of acquittal, and that if we are to be left with a simple guilty or not guilty, then some qualified majority might be appropriate. But I don't think I have anything useful to add to what has already been said by Lord Matthews into what is essentially a policy matter.
Thank you for that. In the submission from the centres, there is, the point is made that given the standard direction that a jury can only convict where the Crown has proved its case beyond reasonable doubt and where there is a requisite majority for guilty, votes for not proven would not logically transfer in whole or in part to guilty. And the way I read that observation, I think it helpfully lays the emphasis on the remaining necessity, whatever we do in these circumstances, for the Crown to prove its case beyond reasonable doubt. And I think what is underlying a lot of the motivation behind this legislation is a recognition that it is already very difficult to secure convictions in cases of a sexual nature. So given the fact that that point of absolute central principle in the criminal cases of the necessity to prove a case beyond reasonable doubt, is that not sufficient assurance for the preservation of the simple majority? That would, because there is that necessity for the Crown to prove its case beyond reasonable doubt.
I think the problem is because the anxiety would be that if it's a simple majority of seven to five, well, I suppose it's a swing of two votes, one vote could change that easily. And how confident can the public be that, in fact, the right decision has been made in any particular case when it depends on just the one vote? And then there are two schools of thought about juries. Is it a one body comes up, or is it a collection of individuals? I'm not sure it's helpful to try and work out which is the right answer to that. But we're concerned that with a qualified majority, I think we can be more confident that the right decision has been reached, whatever it is. And it may be, obviously, as you say, that the if a qualified majority is needed, then it will be a higher hurdle for the Crown to reach.
The point I'm trying to get at is that the necessity, which nobody's trying to change, of the Crown having to prove its case beyond reasonable doubt is, I think we all acknowledge, a big hurdle. In the absence of three verdicts, but in the potential of two verdict scenario, I'm trying to get at what actually materially changes about that requirement? Because that still feels to me like a big hurdle to get over.
It always is, whatever the majority is. And in every single case, that is the test, the standard which the Crown must reach. But I'm going to look at it. There's been a discussion, for example, about whether a single judge should sit. And one of the criticisms of that single judge will bring perhaps a bias. But here we are with a simple majority. That could be a single juror who's decided that, even though it's full after jury discussions. So I still come back to the point. I think where it's going to be decided on one vote, it's difficult to see that's justifiable and would provide confidence. I know it's, logically speaking, it's exactly the same as it is now, because one vote could decide it, where we have two, either the Crown's proved it or it hasn't proved it. But the existence of the not proven verdicts has always been thought to counterbalance it, as Sheriff Cuby has said. Whether in sheer logic that's the case is doubtful. But in fact, I think it probably does, because there are jurors who will. Who knows? In logic, they should find the Crown, return a verdict of acquittal if they're going for not proven. But it's hard to say that's always going to be the case. Ultimately, it's a matter for the Parliament to decide which of these verdicts they want to, which of these majorities they want to enact. But we can only say that we think there's a concern that a simple majority with their own two verdicts is possible to be, it's possibly conducive to miscarriage of justice in due course.
Are there any other safeguards that Parliament could consider putting in place that would, that in the judiciary's view, would be compatible with abolishing not proven, maintaining simple majority on a two-verdict outcome? Are there other safeguards that Parliament could consider to address some of this anxiety without opening up what I certainly air in this committee as a question, which I don't think the public are that engaged about, that we could actually have, under the proposal of this bill, a majority in favour of conviction, but not a good enough majority?
I'm not sure there are. Well, it's not something we've considered particularly, I have to say. And obviously, I'm here to speak on behalf of the judges, so anything I've got to say is effectively off the top of my head, which might not be very helpful and might be wrong. But I can't think of anything offhand. I mean, there's root and branch ideas, like making sure the juries actually return a written verdict, for example, or written reasons. But going down that route would be hugely impracticable, because each one of the jurors might have a different reason, but they might all coalesce and be good ones, some of them might be bad ones, and so you could end up with opening up a huge can of worms which causes more difficulty than it solves. So I'm not sure there is anything I can think of which would ameliorate that. That's why we thought that a qualified majority is possibly the safest and best approach.
Thank you.
I'll bring in Sharon Dowie.
Thank you. My colleague Russell Finlay mentioned earlier on about Section 275 applications. I was wondering if you could tell us, do you support the principle that complainers should have access to independent legal representation when there's an application to use sexual history or character?
Yes, we do. I think we've made that clear, I hope, in our response. We do, because, if I can expand a wee bit, we've sometimes found that the Crown have not opposed applications which should be opposed. I mean, in the old days, I think, if I remember correctly, in 1985, and so they had a broad interest of justice test at the end of it, which we don't have now. It's a pure question of relevance, and even if it is relevant, what the probative value of it is. This really good enough evidence to counterbalance the attack on the dignity of the complainer? And sometimes the Crown's approach is better now, but it has been occasionally in the past such that we think this should be. We've still had cases in the appeal court where we've had occasion to say that the Crown should have opposed this. And in fact, the Crown in the appeal will oppose it at that stage, not having opposed it at preliminary hearing. So I think it's important that the complainer have the benefit of that. Apart from anything else, I think that the complainers should know. There's not enough communication. She should know what the defence are going to say about her and be given the opportunity. Now, it may be also that the complainer might say, yes, that is true, this is what happened, and I'm quite happy to have evidence laid about that because of X. Fair enough. If that's what she wants, we'll still decide whether it's relevant or not, but at least she's been given the opportunity to... I keep saying she, because it could be a male, but we know it's normally a woman involved in this. We think it's important. We've already made that clear anyway, I think, in our submission. And we made it clear in the case of RR, I think, that the complainer should be told about this by the Crown as soon as one of these comes in.
Yeah, thanks. When the Lord Advocate was in earlier on, she actually said that one of the single biggest improvements that could be made was to have better prepared witnesses and to keep them properly informed. Do you think that the bill goes far enough? Do you think that complainers should have independent legal representation right through the process?
Well, there's nothing to stop them having a lawyer, but I think if you mean by that, should the complainer's lawyer be in the court during the course of the trial? We don't think so. We're not going that far. We don't have this parti civil process that they have in other jurisdictions, and we're not sure what role the complainer's lawyer would have in a case like that. We can't have two sets of cross-examination, for example, of an accused person if he chooses to give evidence. That would be unfair. Hopefully the Crown would carry out the function of the, it's a function of the state to prosecute, not the function of the individual complainer. We've got to make sure the complainer's treated properly and that she knows what's going on and is given every opportunity to participate, and as far as that's compatible with the trial process. But putting someone else, another lawyer in, I'm not sure what the role of that lawyer would be, other than perhaps to take an objection, which the Crown should have taken.
And could you tell me a bit more about the concerns that you would have on it causing further delay in the system, and if there's anything that we could do to...
Well, there are delays. I think there are delays inbuilt into this bill, which I'm a bit concerned about, in terms of the Crown. Even the bit we're happy with is the independent legal representation for 275 applications. We're concerned at the notion that the Crown has to ask the court for permission to disclose evidence to the complainer's representative. That will be productive of delay. There's no reason we can think why the Crown can't just do that off their own bat without involving the Crown. If the defence want to object, then they could doubtless apply to the court to deal with it if there's an objection. But we can't imagine any circumstances in which the court would say, no, you're not going to tell the complainer, I'm not going to tell the complainer's lawyer about particular pieces of evidence. But we have to make sure we don't, people aren't coached, because we can't coach witnesses into what to say. But there's no reason why a complainer should not know what's happening and what the likelihood, the type of questions which are going to be asked, and be put on notice about how the defence is going to approach it, which you're probably, you may have heard evidence already about defence statements, which are really not worth the paper they're written on at the moment. But we can't have complainers coming in and being completely surprised. I've had witnesses, complainers, who are taken aback by cross. Nobody seems to have told them that they might be cross-examined, that they might be challenged, and I think that's awful. They should be told that there may be questions which suggest that something else happened other than what you say happened. So I think, I'm not sure, I don't want to impugn the people who are looking after witnesses, but I think I wonder if they should perhaps give the complainers at least better information, because communication is obviously important to the trauma-informed practice.
Okay, thank you. I don't know if Sheriff Cuby's got any comments on...
The Sheriffs and Somerset Sheriffs Association unequivocally supported independent legal representation for complainers in relation to 275, and the observations were limited to the practicalities, some of which Lord Matthews has addressed. I think it's fair to have really considered whether or not there should be a longer-term involvement of that independent legal representation. That's not something I was anticipating, but there is no doubt there is widespread support for legal representation for complainers in relation to the Section 275 applications, subject perhaps the procedure being looked at to avoid the kind of delays that Lord Matthews has talked about.
Okay.
Thank you. We also support it in connection with applications to recover like medical records and that kind of thing. The Appeal Court's already made a plain that should be done.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you. Before I bring in Pauline McNeill, I wonder if I can just ask a couple of questions about the proposals around the rape trial pilot. So, for example, the judiciary's submission, as we know, reflected different opinions on the proposal, which were well set out and helpful. However, I wonder if I can maybe just turn to some evidence that we took from Professor Munro recently, and I'm just going to quote what he said in relation to the proposal for the time-limited pilot. So in our written submission, we've tried to say that a judge-only pilot would not be an unreasonable move for gathering more evidence, and that is akin to what Lady Dorrian said in her testimony to committee on the importance of developing a stronger evidence base for comparison. And then he went on to say part of the reason for having the pilot would be to learn more about what that an alternative would look like and what change that it may or may not result in. So given we've got different views on the proposals around a pilot, I'm just wondering if you, on behalf of the judiciary, might have a thought or an opinion on how we take that information together, both those sides of the kind of coin, if you like, and perhaps think about what a pilot could look like, perhaps with some different thinking around the proposal as it is in the bill, if that makes sense.
Well, in a sense, if I answer that question, I'd be going out on a limb giving my own view, and I'm conscious that it's up to the Parliament, really, to work out what to do. And you know what you say about not teaching your granny to suck eggs.
Could I maybe come in and maybe ask it in a different way, which would be, what, as a committee, what should we be thinking about in terms of what a pilot is seeking to achieve? Would the, you know, given, again, given the range of views of the judiciary...
As I understand it, that the purpose of the pilot is would not be to increase the conviction rate as such, but it's to work out with a judge giving reasons for an acquittal or a conviction to see perhaps if there are trends or what reasons are there for particular decisions being made. To what extent has the decision been influenced by just the nature of the evidence in that case itself? Or are there any indications that perhaps rape myths have played a part or not played a part? That kind of, I understand that's the sort of thinking that Lady Dorian had to analyse just what... and another thing, it's not just a question of looking at numbers in terms of acquittals or convictions. For all I know, they may be exactly the same. I've no idea, just because of the nature of the evidence. But I think it's to look and see if the underlying reasons for the decisions, what they are, and if anything can be done to address those in future. I mean, I know when it comes to rape myths, for example, the jury manual committee have recently issued a new direction, sample directions to be given to juries at the start. And if there's an issue of rape myths, what do you do after that, after the pilot, such as a video, as we suggested in Northern Ireland, setting out, you know, an example without tilting the balance in favour of conviction. We can't do that. Any video would have to be neutral, as it were. But to point out to jurors that there are reasons why people don't give, don't complain right away. There are reasons why people don't resist, and so on. And if that was understood at the beginning of the trial by a jury, perhaps better, maybe a video would be better than a written direction. It may be that would make sure that the decision, whatever it was based just on the evidence and not on any prejudices which people brought to bear with them. I think that's really what the pilot is designed to try and flesh out.
Okay, thank you. Sheriff Cooper, you don't know if you want to come in on anything.
I don't think so. I think the committee has obviously received a lot of information in relation to the consultation, Lady Dorian's review in the first place, the senator's response, other responses. I'm not sure if I can pluck out of thin air some magic answer that would allow the resolution between the competing sides, and I don't think it's helpful to give any kind of personal opinion. It's seen as an evidence gathering. That's the purpose of it, and there's a value in that. The committee will know that jurors can't be asked about why they've reached decisions or what they've done, so there is a dearth of evidence, and the review thought that this might be some way of filling that vacuum. But I don't think I've got anything to add about what you should be thinking about that has not already been part of the very major consultation exercise that's taking place.
I guess the other thing is, it may be, not for me to say, that Parliament could think about actually legislating in more detail what this should be, rather than leaving it to subordinate legislation, which might, an actual act which set out the parameters of any pilot and so on, and what should happen, might be better and carry more weight than subordinate legislation would. But that's, again, just a personal thought.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you for that. I think Fulton McGregor, you want to come in with a supplementary, and then I'll bring in Pauline McNeill.
Yeah. Thanks, Convener. This was the area I was going to actually ask about, was about the pilot for the juryless trials. But you've actually covered a lot of it in the response to the convener. So there's only one further question I've really got in this area, and that's why I thought I'd come in as a supplementary just now. And that's, you know, we heard the evidence a couple of weeks ago that perhaps, not shocked us, but it was witnesses
who were talking about jury list trials, and some of them said that they would have preferred that, or indicated they preferred that, and others said that they wouldn't have, and they would rather that there was 12 or 15 or whatever the number, multiple people making the decision as opposed to one. And so what I wanted to ask, rather than getting into that, is I do think sometimes when we're bringing forward legislation or changes in the justice system, we're doing things that we think that will help victims and witnesses. And therefore, what discussions around the pilot or observations of the pilot do you think the victims and witnesses should have in that? What input should they have in that in terms of seeing if this is the best way to go forward? And is there, I'll just tie all my questions together, is there actually an argument at some point, and I don't know if this would be far too difficult to do, and it's only came to me between sessions, for actually victims, witnesses, complainers, whatever phrase you want to use, to almost have a choice there. So if a jury list trial is piloted, but they said, listen, if you actually want a jury, that's okay, because we did hear clear evidence from witnesses saying, no, I would have wanted a jury. I don't think I'd have wanted a single judge.
Ultimately, that is a matter for Parliament. This was not discussed, that particular issue, but in terms of the involvement of victims' organisations and individual victims beforehand, that's obviously a matter for the committee and Parliament to decide whom they wish to consult beforehand, and I've no doubt you will, and have taken evidence from victims and witnesses. And that having been done, I don't think I can add anything much to that. As far as the choice is concerned, just speaking in general, it's not normally the choice of a victim whether a case is prosecuted at summary level, for example, or at jury level. So whether you want to introduce a choice, I say it's not something as a judiciary we've thought about, but no doubt it's something the committee will think about. And I don't have an answer to you for that. But, I mean, there are a number of people who have to ask, I mean, how do you, is the accused going to choose it? and a judge's role rather than a jury, who knows?
Well, I'm asking about the victims and witnesses because it's a victim and witnesses bill, and I feel that a jury list trial pilot does seem like a good idea, but I'm trying to take into account that there might be different views there. And what I was thinking was, rather than it being a choice maybe further down the line, I'm thinking about in the pilot, because in the pilot, you know, this is real people, this is real victims and witnesses, and it's real accused, so we do have to be careful about even thinking about it as a pilot. So I'm thinking, given it is a victim and witnesses bill, you know, is there scope, do you think, for, you know, well, you're actually part of a pilot, Mrs X, you're part of a pilot, but, you know, you can choose to still have a jury trial. I'm just putting that out.
I would say it's a matter for the Parliament. There's no doubt scope to discuss that in Parliament and decide on that. Justice should be done. No, it should not be done at people. Justice is before people. So I say I can't give you an answer to that because it's not my decision to make, but I think it's a point that is worth making, if I may say so.
Historically in Scotland, the Crown determined the forum in which matters are prosecuted, whether it's summary or indictment level or High Court level. In England, for example, some accused have the opportunity to choose that. I think to consider giving the victims an option would give rise to, as Lord Matthews has already said, the question then of what right the accused has to object to that or to make their own representations about the forum. And I think that would really be a matter for legislating. And of course, if it's to be a juryless pilot and there was an opportunity to say, I want a jury, it begins to undermine the value of the pilot if the victim were to be given that right. So I think that gives rise to a number of other questions, although it's a perfectly legitimate view for some victims to put that they would rather have had a jury than a single judge. But I think it opens up other areas for question and for consultation.
Yeah, I mean, for example, halfway through it, the witnesses, I've had enough, I'd like to have a jury now, or I'd like to have a single judge now, and so on. So that all that kind of thing would have to be considered, but these are the same matters for Parliament to iron out.
Yeah. Okay, thanks. Okay, as I say, more questions on that, but I think you covered it, the convener.
Okay, thank you. And Pauline McNeill.
Thank you. You're quite right, Lord Masters, to say these are questions for Parliament to decide, but I have to say, from where I'm sitting, it's not easy to make some of these decisions which are controversial, and we're not practitioners, so your insights are really valuable. So, first of all, so far, really thank you for the evidence you've given. So, in relation to the jury single judge pilot, and I think Fulton McGrew is quite correct to say, well, it's maybe not appropriate language to say it's a pilot, because that could be a live trial in which Parliament has decided. So my first question that would be helpful to, if you can provide any insights as to your opinion on, so the single judge would be writing up the evidence of the trial, which normally would be left to the jury to decide what they believe, what they don't believe. Any thoughts on how straightforward that is? Obviously, the law will be determined in any case, but by the judge, by the evidence, normally for the jury to decide on. So how do, any thoughts about how this, these written reasons would be
done?
Well,
we do it all the time. In civil cases, for example, we have to assess witnesses as they go along, write the evidence down, which is the most tedious part of any case, is writing down and telling people to slow down while we write it down. So it's not a new thing doing that in any sense. And it's done, the Sheriff Court do it all the time in summary cases, which could be just as complex, if not more so, than some jury trials are. Mm-hmm. So from that point of view, I don't see it as an issue.
Well, that's helpful to know.
As it happens, we're hoping, we had a demonstration a while ago of some new technology which allows speaking to come straight up onto a screen. So if you speak in, if a witness speaks into a microphone, it will be automatically downloaded. So it's all there and it translates as well. And we're looking into how we can roll that out into court, if possible. Who knows how long it will take, but that would save... I need to look down, because it's not easy always to work out what a witness is like. If you're trying to note the evidence, you're not looking at the witness at the same time. At least I'm not, because I'm not as capable of doing both at the one time. So that sort of thing would help. Mm-hmm. We don't have a stenographer anymore, or a shorthand writer to do that.
That's interesting.
So, and we can ask the witness later on, what did that witness say? We have to do it ourselves.
So you see,
and we note the evidence anyway. In court, we note the evidence.
So you're doing that
even
anyway.
At the moment. We do that during the course of the trial, because we might need to refer. We have to refer to our notes if we write a report later on the case. Mm-hmm. If there's an appeal, for example, or a report to the parole board, and if we want to go into the evidence when we're addressing the jury, we need to know what the evidence was. So we do all that already. So I don't think that's a particular issue.
And I, presumably, I'm envisaging as the trial progresses, then the judge will have to determine which witnesses, what story they're believing and what they're not believing as the trial progresses.
I think in any case, you may form a provisional view. You shouldn't form any view, really, until you've heard all the evidence, because things can change quite rapidly, depending on what the next witness says and so on. So you try not to form a view, although you
big
may have provisional ideas.
My final question, you're quite correct to say, and I think it's interesting actually, as to whether or not there should be more primary legislation around a jury list trial, which is very controversial. We know that from the evidence and split views amongst the judiciary itself. Do you think there needs to be clear parameters set as to what is being assessed? So let's say the pilot, or I want a better word, because that's what it's called in the legislation, is run for a year. And as you said, the government are quite clear, we're not looking at the conviction rate. So, to be honest, I'm not really clear how the government are going to assess at the end of it and determine whether it's a good or a bad. I mean, I know you can't answer that, but in your opinion, should it be clearly set out as to what the assessment process or the criteria for assessment should be?
Again, we haven't considered that as a judiciary, so I can't answer on behalf of the judiciary, but generally speaking, I thought any clarity is always helpful. Whether that's, it might be difficult for the Act to set it out, but other than how we go about setting up a pilot, but it may be the policy memorandum to set out something like that about what's expected. But it should be made clear, I think, that the decision in any particular case is not something which should be evaluated of itself, because we're not looking at conviction rates or acquittal rates, because we don't want individual judges to think there's some sort of league table, or the public to think there's a league table of judges who acquit or don't acquit or whatever.
Do you not think that might happen? I mean, it has been suggested that it could be seen as a league table. If you run it for a year and you look at the conviction rates...
Yes, exactly. Yeah. That's why I think if it could be made clear that that's not what it's about, then that would be helpful. But I think you're quite right, though, to call it a pilot with real people in it. That's an important point to make. It's not something that's going to go away. It's not, it's not a, a sort of study, as it were, with mock jurors in it.
Thank you very much, Convener.
Okay, thank you. That might helpfully lead into a question that I was going to ask, staying with the rape trial pilot, and it's on a point that has come up in evidence and I was very interested in. During previous evidence, it was suggested that some concerns about the pilot without juries might be lessened if there were more than one judge involved in a ruling. Now, I'm interested on perhaps if the judiciary has a view on that proposal. You know, it's a hypothetical, and I'll also bring in Sheriff Cooby.
We didn't discuss that as such. Okay. We looked at, I mean, apart from anything else, though, if two judges doing it, we'll need to effectively double the number of judges we've got, I suppose. Mm-hmm. One view of it, but I think Lady Doreen's review considered various models and came up with the idea of one pilot, one judge. So the choices really we were discussing were a single judge or the status quo. Yeah. So we haven't thought about any other issue.
Okay,
but again, that's a matter for Parliament in due course.
Yeah. Thank you. Sheriff Cooby?
Yeah, I'm afraid the same as Lord Matthews. I hadn't considered that. Just to respond maybe briefly to something that Pauline McNeill said, it probably would be useful in advance of the pilot to have some kind of metrics about what the success of it would be, or otherwise. That's one of the concerns, I think, that the Sheriffs and Summary Sheriffs Association raised in relation to the success and whether the crude measurement of acquittals or convictions would be used when that isn't the purpose of it, but some clarification of that would be helpful. But in relation to any development of a single-judge pilot court, I'm afraid it's not something I've given any consideration to, nor has the Sheriff's Association.
No, that's understood. OK, thank you. Well, I'm going to pull this session to a close. Thank you both for your attendance this morning. I think that's been hugely helpful for us. And we'll just have a short suspension to allow a changeover of panels. Thank you again. Okay, thank you. So I would like to welcome our final panel for today. So we have Dr. Andrew Tickell, lecturer in law at the Department of Economics and Law, and Sinead Stevenson-McCabe, lecturer in law at the Department of Economics and Law, both from the Glasgow Caledonian University. So we're very grateful that you've been able to join us this morning. So I intend to allow about 45 minutes for this panel, given that we're primarily focusing on the proposal to grant automatic lifelong anonymity to victims in sexual offences cases. So I wonder if I can just open up with a broad question. I'll come to Dr. Tickell first, and then I'll come to Sinead. So really just to ask if you can outline a bit about the work that you've done as part of the Glasgow Caledonian University project on complainer anonymity and the main findings of the research.
Sure, absolutely. Well, it's great to be with you here this morning. Our project on this really began, I suppose, in 2019. Mm-hmm. And it began as a result of a conversation I had with a newspaper editor about the right to anonymity. One of the most common phrases you see in reporting around this issue in the Scottish media and beyond is that victims, complainers of sexual offences have a right to lifelong anonymity. And in 2019, I believe that was true about Scotland. And then I discovered that it was not. In terms of following up on that comment by the newspaper editor, I was thinking, well, I'm a law lecturer. Surely I can find out where in Scots law it says that this right is enshrined. And to my shock, I transpired that it didn't in fact exist, that the legislation does not extend rights of anonymity to complainers. And so every time the media say they have a right, they are, to a legal extent at least, misrepresenting the situation. And so partly it was that revelation which caused me initially in 2020 to publish a piece concerned about how Scotland sits in the rest of the UK. Everywhere else in the UK does protect a right to lifelong anonymity. Scotland is alone on this score. But above and beyond that, I wanted to take a look at how international jurisdictions have dealt with this issue. A lot of reporting restrictions internationally were adopted before social media, and therefore the regulatory assumptions which underpin them are often based on assumptions that publishers are newspapers and they are TV broadcasters and they are the radio. And of course, we know that is no longer the case. It's no longer the reality. So what I did then was look at 20 different jurisdictions in the common law tradition, including Ireland, Canada, the United States, a range of Australian states, to try and understand what international best practice in this area looks like, particularly where countries have tried to change the law after the advent of social media. And what I discovered, in fact, was that the best kind of legislation, in my view, for this is not simply replicating the English provisions, but is trying to learn the best lessons from the international examples, particularly Australia, which has legislated and generated a whole range of unforeseen but well-intentioned problems as a consequence. And broadly, I suppose, to pull all that together, it's about three things. What offences does anonymity extend to? When does it begin? When does it end? And who decides? Those are fundamentally the policy questions which I think the government had to address in this bill, and which our research has largely spoken to each of these issues. It might be more helpful if we talk about them individually rather than me trying to summarise at that point.
Okay, thank you. Come back to that. I'll bring in Sinead if you would like to add anything to that.
I suppose I would just like to add that we were very fortunate that at Glasgow Caledonia University we were able to work with our students mm-hmm. as part of our work on what we called the Campaign for Complainer Anonymity. Andrew also omitted a key part of his story in relation to when he told me that this was the position in Scots law. I told him he was wrong. I said, no, there is legislative provision. I can't call to mind what it would be, which was my first error because Dr. Tickell is actually very rarely wrong. But I was also ignorant to this fact. And we saw that play out again and again. We said to our students, do you think that you can name a complainer in a sexual offence case? And they said, no. And said, now I had the insight. And so I could say, well, tell me, show me the bit of law that says that. And they also, of course, could not do that. And I think that helped the students think about how they could contribute to public legal education on this issue. And so they've been involved in research. They were involved in building our website around the campaign. They wrote articles for the Journal of the Law Society of Scotland, for Legal Women magazine, and they assisted in preparing the consultation submission that we put in. Our students have been a big part of this process, and I suppose I just wanted to publicly acknowledge that today. And also to say that again and again we see this narrative that it is already the law and therefore what is the problem. But Andrew summed up very well that many of the problems have come to light in the age of social media, and I think that that is something for our students who have grown up as digitally native that really rang true. So being part of the campaign and working with the students has been a really enriching process, I think, for both of us, and I'd like to just put it on record to thank them.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. And I have to say, I did find this your submission fascinating. I didn't know there was quite so much in and around the subject, so it was really interesting to get your perspective. So I wonder if I could maybe just ask you about your views on the provisions within the bill. So from your very informed and expert perspective, generally, what are your views on the provisions as they're set out at the moment?
I think they're very good. I mean, I think they're extremely positive. I think they will set out in general. There may be some areas we can discuss where there's continuing controversy. But overall, I think these learn the best lessons of the international practice, which is really what we were aiming for as a result of this project. I should say that we did, over the course of our engagement around this, recognise that all political parties had committed to doing this. And therefore, it was important to give the Scottish Government the information it needed mm-hmm. about international practice. Because as you say, convener, on the face of it, it sounds simple and it doesn't sound as if it should consume all of these political choices and policy choices. And that was my view as well up to about 2020 when I got into it. You think, no, this is much, much more controversial and there are really important choices to be made. This is an area, if you look at Victoria, you look at Tasmania, where well-intentioned legislative reform has caused really significant problems mm-hmm. for people. And so when I discovered that and unearthed that experience in Australia, I was hugely keen that we don't do that in Scotland. So we were able to share our findings with the Scottish Government at a fairly early stage. So it would be fair, I think, to say that the proposals largely reflect, or actually I would say improve on, suggestions that we articulated in our academic work around this. Mm-hmm.
Okay, thank you. I've got a couple of other questions I'll come in on later, but I'm going to open it up to members. And John Swinney, would you like to come in?
Thanks, Kavira. Thank you very much for being here today and for the important, valuable work that you've done. I'm interested, you know, I think the when we had Lady Dorian in front of the committee, Lady Dorian made the point, which I think is, you know, very important in this respect, that up until the age of social media, the common assumption was that this provision existed because it was essentially voluntarily respected by what one might call the established media. And we, of course, are in a very different era now. So just following the convener's line of questioning, I'm interested in whether you believe the provisions of the bill cast the net wide enough to A, address the current media that we know about, and B, the media that we might not know about that might be yet to come?
I think that's a really interesting question, because I think that when we talk about the established media, we often say that they generally regulated themselves very well. And that is true, but there were also incidents where they did not, and they were not, you know, historic, quite recent. In 2023, we had a case involving the Greenock Telegraph where a complainer could be jigsaw identified, and there was no statutory basis on which a case could be brought to court to challenge that. Went to IPSO and a complaint was upheld there. We saw another case in 2015 involving the Daily Record where a gentleman was identified via a report, and his family actually found out that he'd been involved in the case via reading the papers. So I think that although generally speaking the press did regulate themselves well, the Editor's Code is not law, and I think that that's an important starting point. And I think the bill, I'm just really heartened to see that the bill exists now, that we have these provisions in place that's going to be put on a statutory footing, because I think that's important for the mainstream press as well as the social media age. On the social media point, I think the bill deals with it very well. It covers, I think, the definition of publication, whatever speech, writing, relevant programme or other communication in whatever form, that captures social media. We are all publishers now. Every time we send a tweet, every time you put up a Facebook post, we are all publishers. And the bill captures that and actually does so in a nuanced way, because it also recognises that whilst we are all publishers, we are not all journalists. We've not all had media training, and we don't all understand ethics of publication. And the public domain defence, I think, deals with that particularly well. It acknowledges that social media exists and that we don't want to incidentally criminalise people. But in terms of whether I can go on Facebook and put up a post, students would probably cringe at me referring to Facebook, TikTok, whatever it may be, and put up a post and name someone. I can't do that under the provisions as they are, and I think that's a good thing. It doesn't make a distinction between, you know, what type of publication it is. And we can't anticipate what new platforms will exist, but I don't think the bill tries to do that, and as a result, it's broad. It covers what it needs to.
But in a sense, thank you for that answer, but in a sense, the fact that the bill is predicated on the assumption that publishing is not the preserve of institutions, but essentially individuals, gives you the confidence that, in terms of the research work you've undertaken and looking at other jurisdictions, this represents what one might describe as the strongest foundation for providing that lifelong anonymity.
I think it's interesting when we look at other jurisdictions, because we are very late to this. And so many other jurisdictions, if we think about England and Wales, their current provisions came in 1992. They weren't thinking about Twitter and Facebook and the likes. Although they are captured, generally speaking, when we've looked at other jurisdictions, they are still captured by the rules that they have. We have the benefit of coming late to this, that we can think about how we deal with social media, but I'm not concerned that the provisions of the bill wouldn't capture social media publication. Concerns that we had when we initially responded to the consultation, for example, was not that it wouldn't capture social media, because I think it's quite easy to do that, you just make it broad. Our concerns were more around, well, what happens if someone reshares a post where a complainer has shared their experience, and then actually that's a criminal offence. But now that the public domain defence exists within the bill, I think that's dealt with well. So I do think it represents the best lessons from international comparators.
One final question for me, Kavira. There's then the question of awareness, because in a sense there is... there's been examples where people have not... Well, actually, I suppose in your current assessment, they are, in some circumstances, people will be able to publish information just now because there isn't that lifelong anonymity protection in place. But in terms of getting to the point of how do people become aware of this obligation that, you know, every one of us that decides to impart anything in a public domain now will carry should this legislation be enacted. What have you learned from international best practice about how that can be most effectively communicated? Because we have in front of us, as you have observed, a complex bill with many different elements within it. You're obviously very experienced in this particular element of it. What can we reflect on to the government about the importance of making sure people know what's actually going to be in the law if this bill is enacted?
Yeah, I think that's very important. It's interesting that currently many people believe this is already the law, so I think probably people generally self-regulate quite well in this space. But of course, that is not the position. And so there needs to be public legal education around this. There needs to be good, strong public understanding of the law. And I think that's particularly true when we think about young people. Who are active on social media and could... it could be a really good opportunity if you think about public legal education about making sure that these provisions are well understood, and schools are a good place to do something like that. It's often said that the internet is like a legal Wild West, as if like the rules don't apply there. But that isn't true. The rules still apply on the internet. If you commit, you know, you're inciting violence, you're committing hate speech, whatever it might be, the rules still apply. And so I think that there is generally in the public's mind sometimes a disconnect between the real world and the online world. But I think that that is starting to dissipate, and I'm not too concerned that people will be incidentally criminalised for the reasons that we outlined.
We did actually do some opinion polling on public understandings of this back in 2021, which we received some funding from GCU to pursue, which was very interesting. And what it disclosed was the public didn't really understand the current situation, but a lot of them tended to confirm our anecdotal suspicion, which they're told by the media every single day. I counted over 100 references to waiving your anonymity in the Scottish media since the start of January for just a couple of months. Now, if people already believe that that's the case, then they are acting in that way, even if they're not subject to legal obligations or journalistic obligations. More generally, I think what's really good about this bill is it is informed by the reality of social media. I'm always worried when we talk about the regulation of social media, it's presented as like a big bad, which is universally a menace to people who use it. And of course, it can be, and there are online harms. But people use social media for a range of different things, one of which is so important in this field, is telling their story, saying what happened to them, and other people learning from their experiences. Whether that was the Me Too campaign across the world or in Australia, the Let Her Speak campaign that was about this very issue. If you look at where this goes terribly wrong, you can look at the modern Scottish law dealing with children. So, for example, it's illegal for newspapers and for broadcasters to identify a child involved in a criminal case, but not for random people on Twitter. Why is that the case? It's because in 1995, they legislated in a technologically specific way with regulatory assumptions about what was being regulated, whereas a broad publication approach means that doesn't happen. But equally, what's really good about this bill is these provisions, as Sinead says, on secondary publishers, effectively. What if I share your content? And the bill is realistic about the fact that young people, adults, will share their experiences, other people will share them, and we shouldn't criminalise that behaviour, because this bill is not just about protecting people's privacy and their dignity, it's about giving people the autonomy about deciding for themselves, without references to the court, I want to tell my story, or indeed, I don't want to do so. And that, I think, is a real strength of what's being proposed here.
Thank you.
OK, thank you. I wonder if I could just, before I bring in Russell Finlay, I wonder if I can just ask maybe a slightly left-field question, and it's around extending provisions around anonymity to an accused. I don't know if that's something that you've looked at within your scope of work, but in any case, I'd be interested in what, if any, views you have on that.
Yeah, so this is a question which one is very often asked in this context, and a number of submissions to this committee on the bill from members of the public made this point. Mm-hmm. It wasn't the focus of my research, but I did look at, in each of the 20 jurisdictions I considered, is it the case that if a complainant or a complainer gets anonymity, then the accused does too? And the answer is no. That in fact, now I think there are only three jurisdictions where that applies. So New Zealand is one, where accused people have anonymity, the legislation says for the complainer's interest, not their own. We have the Republic of Ireland in particular, which has had these provisions for some time, and we have the more recent changes in Northern Ireland, which have introduced that there. So I think those international examples tell us that it's not an if-then question, that internationally complainer anonymity is not regarded as necessitating anonymity for people accused of crime. And I would say that if you look at how this works in practice, there are substantial problems with it. Just to give you one rather graphic example, I mean, if there are provisions which say you cannot identify someone accused of sexual offending unless they are charged or unless they're convicted, then it would be a crime for anyone to say that they were sexually abused by Jimmy Savile. Now, that's a very particular example, but I think a very clear one, that when we're talking about reporting restrictions, it's absolutely incumbent on us, and I would argue on you as legislators, to remember this is criminalising speech. Mm-hmm. And that's not something to be done lightly, it's something to be done thoughtfully, realistically and proportionately. And so that is one consequence, I think, of extending anonymity to people who are accused of crime. We know that many people are not prosecuted, sometimes in Scotland, because of a lack of corroboration. So what one would be effectively doing is saying it would be a crime for those complainers to say they were victimised by a named person, and I think that would be problematic.
Yeah, OK, thank you, that's really interesting. OK, I'll bring in Russell Finlay.
Thank you, Convener. Just extending from that point,
point, I suppose, the defamation laws protect individuals as well who may be accused of something. So, yeah. I find this research to be really fascinating, and I, as a former journalist, was guilty of the presumption that you describe. I'm going to hold my hands up. But I think partly due to the fact that the media did and do take it very seriously, and in fact the legal advisors to the media effectively give the impression if the words legal right to anonymity is wrong, right to anonymity by almost convention does exist. But I do see the need to, in the advent of social media, to legislate for this, and I see no argument really against it. I just wondered, given you're quite satisfied with the bill as drafted, did you have any input in the drafting or advising in that respect?
So not in terms of the drafting. However, the article that we published in 2022 in the Edinburgh Law Review, which is entitled "How Should Complainer Anonymity Be Introduced in Scots Law," gave a series of specific arguments about approaches that could be adopted. We did also have meetings over the course of a number of months with the Cabinet Secretary on this, and also with officials in terms of that, but nothing directly.
And one thing it does do is create a criminal offence for those who were to breach this new measure. It struck me that one of the defences seems quite broad in that you don't know you're breaking the law, which I don't think applies in very many sets of circumstances. Are you satisfied with that particular defence?
In terms of a lack of knowledge or a lack of awareness of a restriction, they're quite common, actually, in these cases where you didn't know and had no cause to be aware, potentially, that you were making a disclosure about someone. They're often the case.
Incuriosity as a defence.
Almost. I don't know if that's right exactly, in the sense you might not in good faith know something and therefore publish something which incidentally identified somebody. But I would imagine in many cases your challenge to that is just the challenge the Crown would make to someone who puts information like that in the public domain.
Yeah. I mean, one other issue about this, it's a significant change to the system. There's repercussions potentially in other parts of the world. We've seen what can happen if it goes too far, and the backlash in that respect, and it avoids seeking to do that. But given that this is now part of a bill that includes so many other huge changes and contentious changes, you know, not proven, juryless rape trial pilot, changes to jury sizes and majority, and that's really getting all the attention, do you think this would have benefited from being perhaps a separate piece of legislation?
I haven't considered that, if I'm honest. Given that we're dealing with sexual offences, it seems a perfectly natural home for complaint anonymity to be discussed. I do appreciate that this issue seems uncontroversial compared to some of the others. I think Andrew and I would actually say to that that there are controversies in complaint anonymity. They might not be getting the attention that some of the other issues are.
That's the point. It's not getting the attention. It's when we start thinking about it and talking about it, a lot of this stuff comes to the fore. And we've spent so much of our time talking about these other issues, understandably. So what do you think, Andrew, in respect of whether it might have benefited from standalone scrutiny?
Well, I suppose, I mean, I did start researching this in 2019. We're now in 2024. It was urgent to change it in 2019. So in the sense, any further delays, I think, would be problematic. I think also it's probably worth saying, you know, this bill will amend lots of different elements of the existing law. In parallel to this committee, the Education Committee's considering changes around very similar issues involving children. And therefore, there's been a degree of mismatch, I think, there, both at maybe committee level, I'm not so sure, but particularly at governmental level, that a number of the points we've made to you about this bill, where the Scottish Government got it right, actually didn't mirror over into the provisions about children. I'm pleased to say they now do after the amendments that the Government has laid down.
Because Victim Support Scotland are seeking to have a right of anonymity to child homicide victims, which is similar territory. Do you have any views on that, or has that been something you've looked at?
Yeah, so one of the major surprises, I suppose, from the international research that we did was about the impact of death. I think it's intuitively on a human level, you can understand a sense that why should someone lose their anonymity simply because they were a victim of homicide, whether an adult or a child. And I think that sounds really compelling and is a really important point on a human level. But when you get into the practicalities of it, strange things have happened elsewhere. I'll give you the example of Victoria, and this is about adults. I can maybe come on and say more about the situation involving children, which I think are a bit different. But in Victoria, there were a number of high-profile cases where women had been killed in the course of sexually motivated homicides. And under the rules in Victoria, victims could waive their anonymity themselves, and if that didn't happen, you had to go to court. Now, on the face of it, that does not sound unreasonable, does it? But what happened next? The family members discovered that in the immediate aftermath of their daughters and sisters being killed, it was a criminal offence for them to speak publicly and say, "That is my daughter." And so in Victoria, what we saw was it was victims' organisations and families who had been bereaved who came forward and said, "Why should we have to go to law? And that takes time. It always takes time. And it takes money. And it takes lawyers. Why should we have to do that in order to speak about the fact that we have been bereaved?" And that's what happened in Victoria. And it's what happened in other places that introduced these provisions beyond natural life.
And this might be why Rape Crisis Scotland are the view that anonymity shouldn't continue in after death.
That was certainly, as I understand it, their initial position. I think Sandy Brindley referred to talking to survivors about it and being, and they were concerned about this. But I think that's an inevitable consequence. If the only way you can waive anonymity is to go to court, then that's something we know other people have suffered with, economically, socially, personally. And it does underscore for me the fact this is a crime. You're making it a crime for someone to say, "That is my daughter."
Yeah.
I think the issues concerning children who are bereaved are being scrutinised at the moment around that. I do think they raise slightly different issues. Death is a public fact. It has to be registered in public and causes of death have to be identified. Equally, I'm not sure that the discussion around this recognises some of the terrible realities about who child victims of homicide are killed by. 63% of them are killed by one of their parents. If we anonymise a child who's killed by their parents, you're anonymising their parents. Now, that might be something that is worth doing, and I imagine Victim Support Scotland may say, if it helps surviving siblings, then let's give anonymity to their parents. But we're not intending to give anonymity to perpetrators of crime. And so this is why there's a range of moving parts that fit together and why death is proven so complicated.
It just occurred to me there's one potential consequence where a death certificate would be breaking the law.
Potentially, if it was unlawful to publish it. And also, I really worry about this, that in terms of who you criminalise is such an important issue around this. You know, the fact that someone's been the victim of sexual crime is usually a private matter which can remain private. Where someone is the subject of homicide, adult or a child, their death is a social fact, not simply on paper, but in the communities to which they belong. They disappear from school, or their child, they're posted missing. There's a significant risk that the people you criminalise by passing such legislation are not intrusive members of the media who are publishing gratuitous stories, but they're well-meaning people on Facebook who say RIP and then insert the child's name. And none of us want to do that. No. And so my position on this, and I've had engaged, to be frank with you, with Victim Support Scotland around this, and will be doing my best to try and find a way forward which is constructive. But I do just want to say that the challenges around this are so much more profound than I think have been fully brought out so far in Parliament.
Yeah, no, thank you very much. Thank you.
Okay, I wonder if I can just come in on, you've referenced in Russell Finlay's line of questioning, spoke about children, and in your submission, you talk about how, and I'll just actually read what's written. It's critical that Scots law respects the legitimate autonomy of complainers in these cases and facilitates their decision to share or not to share their experiences without imposing additional legal or economic costs. And then you go on to talk about how that finding the balance in and around all that, it is particularly challenging in terms of child complainers. So can I maybe just ask you to sort of outline a wee bit more about your research, specifically looking at the issues impacting on children?
Yeah, so there's a range of different things. Internationally, the age at which children are able to identify themselves is different in different jurisdictions. Mm-hmm. So some are as young as 16, some are as young as 14 even in some of the states that I looked at. Others are older. In terms of adults, our goal, I suppose, fundamentally was to say that you shouldn't have to go to court. Everything I just said about families applies even more powerfully, actually, to living complainers. You heard, it was a couple of weeks ago, from panels of complainers, all of whom told you their experience of court was a profoundly disempowering one. Mm-hmm. And in Australia, the campaigns, it's the Let Her Speak campaign that was founded by a woman called Nina Funnell and Grace Tame, who was subsequently named Australian of the Year. They made all of these arguments for us that they should be able to tell their own story if they choose to. Clearly, children raise other issues around this, and most of the jurisdictions do have a different provision in terms of dealing with children. Mm-hmm. What I think is important is that we don't criminalise children for sharing content online and don't pretend to be shocked that they might do so. Because nothing is more foreseeable, frankly, mm-hmm. than somebody putting information, even if it's to a limited friendship group, to a mm-hmm. section of the public on the internet. Otherwise, in terms of, is a court-based approach appropriate, which is maybe implicit in your question, at that stage I probably would say that I'm not a children's rights expert mm-hmm. at this phase. And on this, I think we make the point that others, maybe the Children's Commission or others, may be better placed to give you a critical judgment about whether the proposed mechanism is appropriate or not.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. Sinead, do you want to add anything to that?
I suppose all I would add is that I am equally glad to see that it's not going to be a criminal offence for children to identify themselves. The provision that applies 106C for applies to children and adults, so you can identify yourself. And that plays into this idea of autonomy that we've talked about again and again in these cases. In some of the international comparators, we've seen such paternalistic approaches taken. And that can be something that, as adults, we often feel in relation to children. So there is a degree of paternalism, of course, when it comes to the court process. But what we're talking about there is other publishers. We're not talking about the child themselves. And so I think that it is a difficult balancing act, autonomy versus mm-hmm. paternalism. Mm-hmm. When it comes to adults, I'm much more in favour of giving them a significant degree of autonomy. I'm heartened to see that there's no suggestion that you would have to get a court order to share your story with a newspaper as an adult. But with children, there are other concerns, and I think that that tension between autonomy and paternalism is balanced mm-hmm. differently in relation to children. I think that's a good thing.
Yeah. Okay, thank you. I'm going to bring in Pauline McNeill now.
Thank you very much. This is really helpful, your evidence so far. But bear in mind that we've only been aware of this since the proposals were published. So I think Russell Finlay's quite right to say that, I think you said it yourself, Dr. Tickell, that some things aren't as necessarily straightforward as you first think, and this is a good example of it. So I wanted to maybe start with you, Sinead. What are the differences then between children and adults under the proposals in how anonymity is lifted? What's the difference exactly?
So, not to invert your question, but we can start from what is the same. So the same is that, mm-hmm. that both children and adults can waive their own anonymity. Right. That is a good thing. That is empowering for all complainers. The difference then is, in relation to children, is that we're looking at a court process for them being able to share their story more widely with third parties. And that's this extra safeguarding layer when you know that you're dealing with potentially vulnerable young people who could be open to manipulation. So there's this process where you would go through the court, I think the relevant section.
And are they tied together, those two things?
Because
the same mm-hmm. similarities are that they can waive their anonymity.
Themselves.
What's the difference between that and telling your story? You have to go to court to tell your story.
Another publisher, a third-party publisher.
Right.
So if a child wanted to create a TikTok video where they spoke about their experience, they have told their own story.
Understand, right.
If we have someone else telling their story, then you can dispense with the restriction in relation to child victims under 106D, and that sets out a process involved there. For adults, we're not looking at a court process. For adults, it's possible to consent, and if we're looking at what's required for consent, you have to have written consent from the adult complainer, and that's sufficient. You don't need to go through a court process. I think that's a real strength, and I think it could have been very tempting for adult complainers and child complainers to replicate the same system, mm-hmm. and I don't think that would have been a good balancing of autonomy
yeah.
and paternalism.
Mm-hmm. Seems so.
And particularly, I mean, prior to being an academic, I was a solicitor, and I trained in litigation and worked there subsequently. And often litigators are trying to discourage people going to court. It can be costly. It can result in delay. And that's not just in relation to the criminal justice system. That's relation to justice generally. Try to avoid going to court is generally a good motto for a young lawyer. And I think that holds true here. So I'm glad to see that we don't have a truncated system where adult complainers have to go to court in order to get an order so that they can share mm-hmm. their story with the press and the press can run. That would be unnecessarily complicated. Yeah. But children are different. There is a difference there. You have potentially vulnerable young people who could be open to manipulation. And I think having that extra safeguarding layer of the court is a good thing.
So I just wanted to say I've understood how it applies.
Mm-hmm.
So a child under the age of 18 can go onto TikTok and talk about their experience as child victim. Can that be used? It can be shared, presumably, because they're sharing it themselves.
Mm-hmm.
Is there any lines here between publishers or people being able to use that?
So that's a really interesting point and actually something that we raised as a potential mm-hmm. problem. Because when we come down to the defences, when we look at the public domain defence, one of the requirements for the public domain defence is that you have to you have to believe that the person is over the age of 18. So, for example, if your auntie, who knows that you're not 18, reshares your video, the public domain defence doesn't actually apply to her. That's potentially problematic. Now, what we've said in our response to the committee is that police and prosecutorial discretion could be used there to not prosecute the auntie that shares the piece. Would there be public interest in pressing ahead with that prosecution? I think that's very unlikely. But the reality is that the public domain defence wouldn't apply.
This is where I'm having some difficulty. Mm-hmm. I mean, Russell Finlay raised this question because my understanding of Scots law is not knowing it's not generally a defence. Can't say, oh, I didn't know what the law was. And I don't know how the law can make a distinction between your auntie and anyone else. I know what you're trying to say. The auntie should have known that the person was under 18. But
mm-hmm.
So, yes, an ordinary understanding of it. But we are legislating here and we need to get mm-hmm. these bits right. So that is exercising me a little bit. This defence seems to be extremely broad. So other people mm-hmm. with an interest might be using that more widely.
Mm-hmm.
That would be my concern.
So there's actually two defences, I think, here that are getting slightly conflated, if you look at 106F. So there's the defence of written consent. There's essentially three defences at play. So there's the defence of written consent. That's separate. We then have the defence that's the public domain defence. That is where the information is in the public domain and the certain conditions apply.
Yeah.
And those conditions include having no reason to believe that the person hadn't given written consent or they weren't over the age of 18. So that's to stop incidental criminalisation. People sharing... So let's imagine a circumstance in which a newspaper runs a story and I see the story and think, that's terrible, I would like to reshare that, that's wrong. I'm not a journalist. We shouldn't expect citizens to do due diligence on whether a newspaper had the correct written consent and that when they said the individual was 19, they weren't wrong and the person was actually 16. Mm-hmm. That's too much of a burden to put on individuals. So that's the public domain defence. The other defence that I think we're talking about as well is that in subsection 5, a person charged with an offence is a defence if it's established they were not aware and neither suspected nor had reason to suspect that the publication included relevant information. Really what we're thinking about there is not ignorance of the law, not saying I didn't know you couldn't share that complainer in a sexual offence case, I didn't know you couldn't share their name. It's that they had no reason to suspect that there was relevant information there that could lead to identification. What we're dealing with here is jigsaw identification as well as naming an individual. So you could easily share something and actually the wider context then creates a situation in which someone can be identified. And that's really what that's trying to deal with. I don't think, Dr. Keller, I have concerns that these defences are too broad. I think they're sensible. I think they don't mean that all of us could accidentally...
You don't think a good lawyer could drive coach and horses through this last defence?
I don't.
Because it is extremely broad. Because my understanding of jigsaw identification is why we're doing anonymity in the first place. So you can't piece it together, say, well, that must be that person.
Yeah.
But we're talking about the defences here. You're clear you don't have any concerns that a good lawyer could drive a coach and horses through that last one, which they
No, I don't. And, you know, as legal people ourselves, as a qualified solicitor myself, I don't have concerns about that provision. I don't know, Dr. Kell, I don't think you do either, but perhaps you want to add.
No, I don't really share that. I mean, because it's not ignorance of the law being no excuse. It's ignorance that you've put something in the public domain which could give rise to someone's identification. And I think we do need to discriminate, as the law always does, between intention, mens rea, as all legally blonde fans know, and other forms of intentionality have to be proven in court. So I don't see this as significantly problematic. We do need to have adequate defences to ensure that we're not sweeping people into criminalisation who we don't intend to. It is certainly, though, fair to say that what counts as jigsaw identification and what kinds of information can give rise to identification is an issue which, until fairly recently, there were no Scottish judgments about. There are judgments in England about that, but often they're rather fact-sensitive. We know that in the last session, the Parliament itself was faced with some of the challenges of identifying whether information could give rise to the identification of individuals or not. I suppose what I would say is that in the international practice, all of the states I've looked at really adopt this approach. All of them have something similar, which says that we need to avoid publishing information which would give rise to someone being identified. And as Lady Dorian said in the solitary judgment around this, that that's not a test about the average punter on the street, about whether they would be able to apprehend who the person was, but someone who worked, for example, with the complainer. Now, that can be difficult to judge in any given case because it is so context specific. I suppose the safeguard here is that individual courts would have to decide these questions. The Crown would have to determine that it was worth bringing proceedings against a publisher who had done so. And if they were going to make good these defences, then they'd have to provide some account which made them out.
Thank you. Just one final question. Just on this issue of where there's a child who wants to share the story, so that bit, you go to court. Could you give us any evidence to what the court might consider? And I was just thinking to myself, if you're a publisher, if you're a newspaper, you might want to offer some money for someone to lift their anonymity. So you might be saying, well, that's up to the person if they want to do that or not, but have they thought through all the consequences of sharing the story when the money looks good? Any evidence you could give of what you think the court would look at in the so whether or not to allow that anonymity to be waived, and might they take that into consideration, do you think?
The bill's also really good on this because it sets that out quite clearly, and it says that the sheriff would have to take into consideration that the child understands the nature of an order, so the nature of an order being made where their story would be shared, appreciates the effect of making such an order, and give consent. And also the sheriff would have to consider that there's no good reason why an order should not be made. So there's criteria there that have to be worked through, and I think they're really thoughtfully drafted. It's not just that they understand the nature of the order, they appreciate the effect, they've given consent, and there's no other good reason why an order shouldn't be made. So I think that there are safeguards in place here that deal with exactly the situation that you're discussing. So I think it's a positive piece of drafting on that.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to bring in Sharon Dowie in a moment, but just maybe kind of following on from Pauline McNeill's last question, what's coming to my head during the session is how, you know, we've spoken about autonomy in terms of a victim and this perhaps control choice that they make, the choices that they make and the control they have. How do we inform a victim, or what sorts of things should be considered in terms of how informed a victim is in relation to those choices that they have around anonymity, so that you're balancing, you know, the sort of legislative provision, if you like, their welfare, their right to autonomy, and so on. So it's more a practical question around what that would look like. How do we tell them what anonymity is about, what it means for them?
I think that's something that organisations have done really well. I'm thinking particularly of Rape Crisis Scotland. They've worked closely with survivors, for example, Miss M, when we think about the civil rape case, who has maintained her anonymity. They've also worked with survivors who spoke to yourselves at the committee, who have not to say chosen to waive their anonymity, because we know that that is not legally the case, but who have very publicly identified themselves. So I think there are organisations out there who are doing that work and doing that work in a really important and impactful way. It's difficult, though. It's very difficult because I think the Lord Advocate said earlier that not all complainers are the same, and we wish that we could give complainers bespoke support, bespoke and individualised support. And the truth is that our criminal justice systems, our rape crisis centres, there is a lack of resource there that means you can't always give that individual support. But I think that organisations like Rape Crisis are doing that and doing that well. Yeah. And it's important that survivors can speak out. I think Hannah McLaughlin, when she spoke to you, said that we shouldn't be pushing for everyone to remain anonymous. And that's absolutely not what we want to do with this campaign. And I'm heartened to say that's not what the government wants to do with this bill either. And we want survivors to have that choice. Mm-hmm. How that choice is made, of course, comes down to the individual survivor, the individual victim. But there are organisations that can provide that kind of support.
Yeah. Good. Thanks for that. Okay, I'll bring in Sharon down then. Russell Pinley's want to come back in.
Thank you. Sharon. It's actually just really to go back over something that Pauline McNeill had said and to make sure that my understanding's right on it. In paragraph 38, it says, as drafted, the bill would criminalise a family member, friend or stranger who shared a child victim's social media post disclosing that they were the victim of a sexual crime. This would not necessarily benefit from the public domain defence already discussed. So would that take into account like somebody's auntie that should know that they're over? So we would actually be legislating to criminalise the auntie for sharing a post that the complainer had actually put out of their own free will?
If that complainer was under the age of 18, yes, that is the way the bill currently reads. And I can see there's confusion on your face there, and I can understand that, because that public domain defence is there to deal with exactly that kind of situation in relation to complainers. It's because a distinction has been made between complainers over the age of 18 and complainers under the age of 18. What we also say in our submission is that, realistically, do I think that auntie would be prosecuted? Well, there is always prosecutorial discretion. There's police discretion. Would there be public interest in pressing ahead with that prosecution? But you are correct to say that's our reading of the bill, that whilst the individual themselves could, under the provisions as they currently stand, waive their own right, resharing that media could be problematic. And that's perhaps something that should be considered in terms of amendments going forward.
Right, so even if there wasn't a complaint from the child complainer, they could still be prosecuted by the police for sharing the post?
You mean if the child complainer themselves didn't go to the police?
So the child complainer didn't complain.
Yeah.
They've put the post out, it's been shared by friends and family, and if they're over 18 and they know that the person who shared the post is over 18...
Under 18.
And the person that's shared it is over 18, but they know that the complainer who originally put the post out is under 18, then somebody other than that child complainer could actually just go in and prosecute them.
Well, so I suppose there's a couple of things there. The first is that even if another child shared it, that other child under the age of 18 could be prosecuted here, even if the child didn't go to the police and report the offence. That's the nature of our criminal justice system, though. It's not the victim that takes forward a prosecution. But would that happen in reality? Are the police going to say your auntie did that and that breached the law, and we've done our detective work to get to this point? Very unlikely. And if someone else were to make a complaint, I think there would be police and prosecutorial discretion about whether that would go ahead. But whether on a black and white reading of the law that would be a potential criminal offence, that is the current position.
So it could happen.
It absolutely could happen.
Okay, thank you. Interesting point. Russell Finlay.
Thanks. Just a quick point of clarification. So as drafted, someone under 18 could put their own experience on social media. They've got that autonomy. And that could get 10, 20 million views. It could be viral. But if the BBC wanted to then report that, they would have to go to court in order to get a sheriff to say that's okay.
Yes.
And a sheriff could say no, because the phrase was, their child has to be deemed to be understanding of their actions.
Yes.
So you could end up with a bit of a odd anomaly whereby this is viral, everybody in the planet knows about it, but mainstream media who've had this barrier or this requirement are unable to. Is that problematic, or do you think that will just work out through application?
I think it could be problematic. I think what we see in tension here is that we want individuals themselves to be able to share their story in the way that they choose to share it. And that's why their video going viral, that's them speaking via that particular medium. And also I think Paul McNeill made a really interesting point. There's no money involved there. There's no kind of commercial interest at play. But you are correct to say that the BBC wouldn't be able to run the story under a public domain defence the way they would with an adult without going to court. And that safeguard's there to protect children in situations where they could potentially be manipulated. I think it's a bit of an anomaly in drafting. I'm not sure that it was picked up.
I think there's probably... you can explain this by comparing and contrasting what's proposed with what happened elsewhere. So elsewhere, in general, it is a crime for children to identify themselves as being involved in the case. So that makes it, on one level, much more straightforward, because it's a crime for them to put out a video about it, it's a crime for anyone to share it, it's a crime for anyone to publish it. I think, in terms of the thinking underpinning the bill, one, the government don't want to criminalise the child who shares the content. I think that is the right impulse, but as I think you correctly point out, this is in tension with the realities of social media sharing. The provisions in terms of children allowing third parties to publish about them are clearly based on assumptions that we're talking about a major Scottish newspaper, we're talking about a major concern that will share this story with the nation, as opposed potentially to whatever international community might engage with it on social media. I do think that is problematic for the reasons that you have identified, but that is the reason why we have this tension. The only way we have it is because it's not a crime for the child to identify themselves. And it's probably useful to think about it that way, because the bill doesn't say children have a right to waive their anonymity. What it says is they don't commit a criminal offence if they identify themselves. And that's why we end up where we end up. But I do think it is problematic, and it does show you why the regulatory assumptions we make and then the language in our legislation does have to graft on to reality. And I think that is an area, certainly, where there is a risk potentially of over-criminalisation. But how do you square that? How do you form a provision which doesn't criminalise a child and yet at the same time has mechanisms in place to protect children from being exploited by cynical media organisations?
Just very, very quickly, if it's okay, the bill says picks the age of 18. It differs in other jurisdictions. You say in your submission this is potentially the most contentious element of the proposal, and suggest, and the colleagues will probably kill me for this, that we should be seeking further evidence from children's rights experts. Again, this brings me back to the earlier point about perhaps this needing greater scrutiny, and I know you don't want to delay anything, but given you're not settled on 18, if I understand correctly, you believe we should be taking more evidence in that respect?
Well, I think we certainly recommended that you should around this. I think, as we've seen in a range of different criminal justice contexts, there is a degree of incoherence about our thinking around age thresholds in terms of what you can do when you're 16, 17 and 18 does feel rather all over the place. And I think that's not necessarily a bad thing. I mean, lawyers generally tend to say we should have clarity and consistency. But in fact, what we know about childhood and evolution into adulthood is that it is a thing of steps and stages, and that the law frequently has to draw hard and bright line rules which don't really graft onto reality very well. I mean, there is an argument you might make that 18 is too old, frankly, that if we're allowing 16-year-olds to choose whether you should be an MSP or not, then why shouldn't we allow them to...
I think that one's been binned, but yeah.
But in that context, if we're making those kind of choices, then many 16-year-olds will feel robust enough and will potentially resent these restrictions on their rights to go public. So that's something I've been mindful of going through it. Most of the jurisdictions I've looked at, almost all of them, say children are handled separately in some sense. But I think it's perfectly legitimate. And if young people came to you and said, I'm 17 and I should be able to go public, well, I would be inclined to support that personally.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
I think we'll draw our session to a close. I wonder if I can just ask a very final question. We've spoken a lot about social media, I was interested in your sort of response about the broadcast media and how, you know, it would appear that there are greater restrictions on broadcast media than, say, social media. Given that many social media platforms, I think that's what they're called, sit out with the UK, how difficult would that make it in terms of our sort of scrutiny of how anonymity for victims is being upheld, if you like, by social media companies?
Well, I suppose there's a few different things there. There are the standards of service and how old people should be to access them, which seems to be something more honoured in the breach than the observance in many cases. I suppose in terms of the reality, who is most likely to publish material which identifies a complainer in a case of this kind? Mm-hmm. It's someone who knows them, someone potentially with a grudge, someone who disbelieves them. So I think the social issue, if you like, and the social knowledge about people is likely to be here, not elsewhere. Mm-hmm. And so that reality, I think, and given the private nature of most sexual offending happening behind closed doors, it's likely to be people with a demonstrable connection to Scotland who potentially breach these rules. Mm-hmm. And indeed, we have seen in recent prosecutions for contempt orders, one of the individuals who was prosecuted for contempt in a recent case had shared material while he was abroad, thinking that this was likely to preserve him from any consequences. It did not, because he had a connection with Scotland and was back in the country. So I think in terms of that, sometimes we can envisage the internet, Wild West as it can be, as being much harder to regulate than sometimes it is.
Yeah.
And I think this is a good example of where these will not be ineffective provisions, not least because they build on a real foundation of social consent. Our polling shows, public attitudes suggest, media practice underscores that people in general accept the principle that you should be able to come forward, that you shouldn't face broader social consequences for taking the very difficult step that many people do not do, and I do not blame them for it, to come forward and speak about what they say happened to them. So this will serve a range of interests, from privacy, dignity, autonomy, but also the administration of justice as well. And all of these, I think, are really important values which will really benefit from the core provisions set out in these proposals.
Okay, thank you. Thank you for that nice roundup. That's most helpful. Okay, so I think we'll close the session now. Thank you very much indeed for attending. It's been fascinating. Next week, we'll return to victims, witnesses and justice reform with two meetings. The first is on Tuesday, and that will be with the Scottish Solicitors Bar Association. And the second will be on Wednesday with the Cabinet Secretary. And that will be our final evidence session on the bill. So thank you so much. And we now move into private session. Thank you.